way worse.
The only people that would get fucked up are the 1%.
No, the ones that's that are a lot. No,
let me tell you something. Let me finish. What is the top? Okay, what the U.S. economy? What is it based on? It's based on weapons. Those companies are owned by the 1%. They sell their weapons everywhere.
All right, listen.
Okay, if it's
I don't think I'm getting any money either. So if they stop selling weapons, I'm not gonna lose something I never will get.
Fuck
it. Place.
Yeah. Bro, US if Mark Zuckerberg $500 million
Fuck Mark Zuckerberg.
Do you think Mark Zuckerberg cares if he woke up and lost $1 billion overnight? You think he cares?
No, I'm gonna go to the race stations and you see if they got another Mike over there.
No, bro, right now. I don't think he cares.
Alright, so let's say collectively the Bronx, our community, woke up and we lost $1 billion. Do you think we care?
I don't think they had $1 billion.
We have $1 billion.
That shit would hurt, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That doesn't have $1 billion.
That shit would hurt. If Mark Zuckerberg lost $10 billion, he wakes up and does this.
Man, they just made $3 million.
If we lose $10 billion, do you know what we lose? Everything.
We will lose that.
Everything.
Listen, bro.
Regardless of how we feel about this country, we are inevitably tied to its fate. We spend American money.
You're right. Okay, we need to wake up then. If we need to go through some civil war crisis, that's what we need to do, because we need to get our shit together.
We're on the losing end of that, because when it comes down to a civil war or like a divide in this country, if you want to really get break it down over there, we have the least amount of resources. We don't have anything. We don't own a commodity that we can go to and go, you know what, this is ours, and like, you know, this is what we're going to hang on to survive this. No, we don't have anything like that, bro.
What are you talking about? You're talking about America as a country?
Break it down.
What are you talking about, people in the Bronx?
Break down demographics.
If the country loses, oil.
Yeah. Entertainment, oil, precious metals. What else? Let's say, I don't know, I guess
I get what you're
institutions,
saying.
Okay. Stuff like that. Anything that makes up the infrastructure of a country, we have no part.
That's in a capitalist system, though. That's in a capitalist system.
Capitalistic system. The only thing wrong with it is that we're not on top, bro.
No, the only thing wrong with it is that you have to oppress other people to get on top.
My man's.
How did capitalism start, though?
That's how it starts. But
tell me how it started. Honestly, tell me how it started. All these capitalism countries came out of the African slave trade.
Yes.
That's how capitalism started.
Yes, that's how it started.
That's how capitalism will always be.
We need to flip the script.
If capitalism is going to exist, then yeah, we need to be on top of it. But if there's a chance that capitalism could fall, then capitalism needs to fall.
No, it does not need
to fall.
Need to take it
you
over,
have
bro.
To overpre- you have to oppress other human
overtake.
Beings to be on top of capitalism.
Bro, you can't bro, that's overtake a very, it. Very bro, naive way to the 1% is already in control of everything. The welfare that you got English is not my native language. The welfare that you get, you're saying that, okay, we would lose, let's say, $100 billion for the Bronx funds or something. That comes from the taxes.
Yeah, it doesn't come from that.
Businesses
that we employ ourselves at.
The 1%.
Employ ourselves. Capitalism you're still talking about.
Hold on. They make a lot of money and they don't pay taxes.
Exactly.
That reflects all of that. And that's what they're trying to do. Keep people who are working class paying taxes, and they get away with taxes.
Y'all don't even realize what's going on. Did you know that this year is the year that they're predicting the entire retail market to collapse? Did y'all know that?
That's good.
2018.
That's good.
2018. Toys R Us.
Who is they?
Financial economists.
So they predicted Toys R Us closing their doors.
Already happening.
You're not writing nothing down.
You're eating a sandwich right now. Hold on. They predicted that happening in 2022, bro. Like, H&M going through a crisis right now. H&M has so many clothes backlogged from their last season. It's all a big story. Though? Because these things are collapsing.
How is this
because capitalism cannot exist.
Because the leadership in charge of the country does not know what they're doing.
Bro,
wait,
that
how
sounds,
are they related to these private companies?
That sounds
so,
bro.
H&M is a private company. Toys R Us.
You know what company coming back?
So how is the president and what?
You know what company coming back?
I guess the American Dollar or whatnot.
Huh? EBA Toys. You know that the old ass toy company.
Yeah, what's that guy doing?
Listen.
EBA Toys making a comeback now.
Well, they're not doing anything.
Look, here's what I'm saying. The first casualties of anything that collapses in America is poor people.
You're right.
People don't understand this. So, like, we are going to be the first ones to get thrown into the meat grinder.
You're right.
Like, our communities are going to be, whatever's left of them, is going to be destroyed.
That's true. You're right.
They're going to be kicking us out by the droves.
Explain to me how this H&M closing down, Torsman closing down, related to the
government. All right, so, like, let me...
Related to the economy.
Yo, real quick, real quick.
The economy, but how is that, like, related to... Okay, so, like, Obama did differently that made it not shut down.
So, like, I'm explaining. Perfect example. So, the first mistake we did was when Donald Trump pulled out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. The TPP, TPP is right?
Not good.
Right? No, no, no. Here's the thing.
Fuck the TPP.
No, the TPP is actually... No, it's not. What is terrible. It was a trade partnership, basically, that, like, brought Asia closer to the Western world and pretty much opened up trade markets for us towards Asia. Yeah. So, like,
so instead how do you bring Asia closer to the...
Well, because like,
contracts and treaties and stuff.
It allows you to sell your products without having to pay a lot of taxes. So
and they can sell their products here also?
Yeah.
America back and forth.
So the NAFTA agreement was the Western world's first attempt at like, actually having... legislated globalization, like they're trying to merge people's economies so they can benefit of it. Canada, Mexico, and United States of America have been doing this for decades. So they're like, all right, let's include some European countries and let's include some of the smaller islands. And it worked out.
Can I ask, you know why? What is the reason for that? Why is it happening?
So I'm getting to why happened?
No, he's saying that people are, you know, pulling out, you know, from these, you know, globalization.
No, people aren't pulling out. Our last three presidents have worked very, very hard because it started with the Clinton administration and then George Bush worked on it and then Barack Obama worked on it.
These three people were good for black people, is what you're trying to say?
No, listen.
So why, if they wasn't good for black people, why do I care what they good for the... All right, right, right.
Clinton was not good for black people.
Clinton was not good for black people.
I don't think we were selling enough.
Talking about how the administration directly affects trade. Hold on, let me finish this.
All right. I gotta say something after that.
Right. So NAFTA agreement brought all these people to the table, right? So the TPP,
H&M, they can sell to Asia because there's no taxes.
All right, Toys R Us. All right, so first off, H&M isn't an American company, so like they literally benefit off.
Let him stick to a point.
Basically.
Because I don't see how this affect me as like one black
guy. No, we'll go back to that.
So the Trans-Pacific Partnership was the first trade agreement that literally would have benefited American businesses more so than would have benefited anybody else.
It would benefit the whole world in general.
Yeah. Okay. Normally,
because you can go to Asia, buy stuff, and bring it over here and not have to pay
taxes. No, not really. No. So I would buy something online from Asia and not have to worry about anything. It would be delivered to my house without worrying about
Very, very, very smooth.
And then if you take out that agreement, what do you have to worry about?
Tariffs.
Customs.
Right.
All those stuff.
Now, fast forward to 2018, right? When Trump pulled out of the TPP, mind you, economists like, listen, had he kept in there, he would have had a whole bunch of economic things that he wouldn't have to worry about. It would have been a self-oiling machine for him because he doesn't understand how foreign policy works. But when he pulled out of that, he goes, okay, America first, blah, fucking whatever. And then he starts applying trade tariffs to China and other neighboring countries around there. So, listen.
Because he pulled out. He would have to have new ones.
So, all right, cool. So, The Dow Jones has had its worst 3-month quarter ever. The Dow Jones stock market.
Yeah. Which was founded on my ancestors' back.
It's had its worst
quarter.
But listen, though. It's founded in bad blood, but this is something that we need.
No, I don't need it. Right, I'd rather go to war and reshape the whole planet.
No, we don't have anything to go to war with. Listen, Dow Jones.
How was it founded in bad blood? What happened?
It's long story. Yeah.
A fucking point.
Listen, capitalism is started on the back of slavery.
The Dow Jones had its worst quarter ever since the Great Depression. Ever. Okay. Ever in the history of the Dow Jones. So cool. So this is it. Is a direct, pretty much, just symptom of what Donald Trump's administration is doing. So after this, now retailers are closing. They are the biggest job providers to people of color. People don't understand this. Retailers
You're getting all wrong.
Capitalism.
Okay. And why is that, though?
Can I ask?
How come we can't get any other jobs?
Y'all because we're not allowed in these other markets.
So, because we want to be part of the Western society instead of building our own shit.
What was he going to say?
We need a wake up. Yes, we do. We can grow our own food. We can grow our own food, but instead we decide to go to the supermarket.
Hold on.
What is he saying?
Listen to me. It's really important because we are people of color, everyone in here. We're not white. Okay, and we got to understand what's going on.
No,
it's exactly what you're saying. Yes, but what is the reason for that?
Let him finish.
You already heard of the Brexit, right? One.
Yeah, Brexit.
England.
That shit is not bad though.
Let me finish.
Brexit was bad.
Okay,
it was
stupid. Okay.
Hold on. They're not doing terrible.
Let me finish, bro. Let you talk. Okay, so we understand. Again, we all people of color. We are the most people that's gonna get fucked. Okay, conservatives are rising. Everywhere in England, they were rising, so they took over the parliament, so they pulled England out of the European Union. Yeah. Right? Correct. All right.
But like, they paid for that. Hold on. Prime Minister made pay
Hold
for
on.
That.
Donald Trump. Okay, what happened? Conservatives, with the new Nazis, okay, came together and started supporting him, and he actually won the elections, and he pulled from the whole treaty agreement that provided, you know, the whole universe to trade with each other without taxes. Correct?
Yeah, they cheated. You're not going to be present.
Why is that? Because they want to fight globalism. Globalism is when everyone of us become one nation. Okay, we don't have to worry about all of these governments. And if you really notice, people who are controlling the governments are white. And if we allow people, you know, to trade for freely and they exchange all of that stuff, they become all united, and they don't want that to happen. They want to still be in power. They want to make sure that the white people are in power. They want to become conservatives. They want to make sure they secure only the 1% and keep selling fucking weapons to third world countries. So do you get my point?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the reason that Trump pulled out of the agreement. Because right now he wants to write agreements with different countries based on what he wants.
Exactly. Yeah, like based on what he deems valuable from them. Yeah, but like you're missing the point though. The consequences of him doing this is affecting us the most.
Yeah,
it's gonna affect our economy.
It's already affecting our economy.
It is.
We can't afford to have him in office.
We can't afford to continue working with the economy. The economy needs war. The economy needs debt. The economy needs slavery.
Yes.
The capitalism system can only exist by oppressing other people. So therefore, that system does not need to be in place.
Listen, as long as this machine is in place, we have an opportunity to get some kind of commodity that we can have for sustainable wealth. If this whole thing collapses, we lose that opportunity.
I agree with you.
Socialism is not going to work in America because of the racist white people.
Bro,
like
we're not even.
I agree with you
we're
about the commodity stuff.
For socialism,
I agree with you about the commodity stuff. No, I agree with you, and that's what we're trying to do right now.
But if there's
an opportunity that capitalism will fall before we even get to that point, I'm totally fine with that.
We're fucked, bro.
No, we're not fucked, bro. We had to survive in this shit for how fucking long? No, think about all these people in third world countries that guys fucking survive without lights and shit, without running water. Huh? You thinking the economy collapsing is gonna affect us?
Yo, they literally.
Bro, how many nights you had to stall?
There's nothing about living here. We're prisoners.
Bro, I gotta go.
Capitalism. We're prisoners in this city.
It's the worst thing that ever happened to humanity.
No, it's not.
I'll tell you that.
Yes, it is.
Capitalism is the worst thing happened to black people. But if we were in charge of this shit, it would be way better.
Humanity. Bro, who are you talking about? You're not talking about mankind.
It makes you prejudice. What is that word?
Prejudice.
Exactly. So you would do anything to just fuck me over to make sure that you end up with the better results in whatever you want. Whether it's business, whether it's anything. So
like, y'all think if we were in charge of that, the people who perfected trade,
it would be better.
People perfected trade.
I think the best thing
people perfected trade.
You to be satisfied with whatever you have.
I do. I agree with you. I agree with you 100%. But what I don't agree with you with is if capitalism is going to fall, I'm not going to give it a pillow. No, I'm not going to give it.
It's a mechanism.
I'm not going to help it to survive.
It is bad.
The people running it is bad.
I agree with you 100%. But the thing is,
it makes you like Trump.
I'm not gonna help capitalism continue when there's a chance that it might fall though.
And how does that happen if you want to make a lot of millions? You're gonna have to oppress people. You're gonna have to make him hire someone that's gonna be working for $8
an hour. We don't have the ability to oppress people in America, bro.
Bro, it is. People are oppressed until today. What are you talking about?
No. I said we, people of color.
We're fucked.
We don't have the ability to oppress other people in this country.
We don't.
I guess you're saying that if it was the other way around,
we different, bro.
We're oppressed. So what do you mean? What do you have to worry about?
No. We don't have to worry about anything. Saying this, if we were in charge of capitalism, we don't have the means.
Wouldn't we still have to oppress people?
We're not in charge.
If we were, it would be a better place.
It's not.
We still have to oppress people,
bro.
Yes, it would be.
Again, according to capitalism, if we was on top, wouldn't we have to oppress people?
Because survival of the fittest.
We have to oppress
people. Because the capitalism, they always try to get the most profit margin. We could get this much profit margin.
Democrats
still
have something to fall on. They have
whole countries to go to.
They have entire mechanisms, entire commodities in which they've used to build their wealth. If we were on top, they would have that to fall back on. It wouldn't be like
that.
Their communities are not in survival.
They don't have a whole country to go to.
Exactly. That's why we're going to have one. So we need to be the one that's going to have this. That's what I'm saying. Yes, I agree with that.
So still, it's a
before I go, look, the most important thing, we got to realize that we have to be fucking united.
See, I don't know about politics. I just
you know, always fucking right chill. Always
oh, yo, like, we've been on this, but yo, sir, what's your name, man?
Allah.
Jared, nice to meet you, man.
Your name is Allah?
Allah.
Allah.
Not Allah.
What's your name?
Where you from?
George.
Where you from?
No, me.
Yemen.
Yemen, yo, well, South Yemen?
Not South.
North Yemen.
It's a country.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But like, you would be in the south side of Yemen. North side of Yemen.
Yeah. North, what, like Sana'a or?
Not Sana'a, in the middle.
In the middle? I see, yeah. Yo, man, my good friends are from Yemen. My good friends.
I thought you were telling
you. Yo, man, people I grew up with from Yemen, man.
Oh, cool, yeah. A lot of them. We're cool people.
Yeah, man.
Where you from, Jared?
Let's think you a spy.
Uptown where?
From Capitol Hill.
He's from the Bronx?
That's
not a joke, I'm serious.
He's from the Capitol Hill. My sister said that was gay.
What surprised me is, that, I don't think, you know, someone that would make these claims.
You think it would gay if he has one hand, one hand?
Yeah. It's kind of weird.
No, so here's the thing.
It's kind of weird.
Is that gay?
No, not yet. It can, though.
Do you identify as being gay?
It can, though.
Do you identify as being gay or bisexual?
You know, I didn't think it was cool.
Don't put it on both hands. But if I walk outside with a dildo,
yo.
What?
Bro, we were talking about this and now y'all talking about something else.
Did I look gay, right? I don't understand.
Bro!
People who came from nobility. Yes. Capitalism changed that. You got people who... Their grandfathers were poor.
You talking about European systems, though.
I know. Why did it change?
You talking about European systems.
It's a tool, bro. It doesn't matter who made it.
Yes, it does, though. Because the history that you're talking about is not our history.
It's a tool. It doesn't matter.
I agree. You're not talking about us, though.
I agree.
No, I'm talking about what you said. What did you say before capitalism?
I'll tell you something. Why you don't let us educate ourselves and become, you know, and come up with our own
system. Exactly. Yeah.
That will be
the history that you're using and the system that you're talking about. They were all systems from other people that came and oppressed us.
Yeah.
So why we have to follow their history and their system?
Why can't we apply it to us and learn?
We can apply it to them, but if it's gonna fall, we shouldn't help it though.
It was born.
But if we become take over the capitalist system, we would have to oppress others.
That's exactly. What you mean oppress?
Because look,
if it's still capitalism, you have to oppress the system of exploitation.
Profit. You're gonna try to make as much profit as you can, even if you fuck other people.
Thank you. Exploitation. How do you exploit people who own everything? They have something to fall back on.
But that's
you cannot
not true.
Exploit
that's
people not who have no. wealth to fall back
not
on. If you're a billionaire, if you're worth $50 billion, and I take $40 billion, are you living in squalor? No,
real,
you're not,
so
bro.
Let's say
you're still a billionaire.
So everything
that's not
switched.
Oppression.
But,
that's not how oppression
switched.
Works.
But why you bring that up, though?
Because what I'm saying is, he's saying it's capitalism is exploitation. If we flip the script and we became the ones to run the system,
that
these people will lose a lot. These people will lose a lot of money.
But who are you talking about, though?
Some of the rich 1%.
That's 1%. You can't run capitalism over 1%.
People. He already runs on 1%.
No, I'm saying the 99 is gonna run 1% of people. You
bro.
Can't run capitalism up
yes,
that way,
bro.
So 99% of the people is gonna run this about people.
All right, so. Let me explain my
plan. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I just explain my plan. First, hold on. First off, the political system. America is directly responsible for every single racist ideology, philosophy, or legislation that it has passed.
And the Europeans.
Every single last one of them, bro.
The Europeans helped, though.
Every single last one of them.
And North Africa.
Every single last one of them, bro. From Jim Crow, all that shit. Every single last one of them, bro.
You're not even ready.
These racist ideologies started in Europe. Some of the racist ideologies started in Europe.
No, come on. Look.
Said you can enslave people based on your skin tone.
All right, let me
preach.
Refine this thing. What I'm saying is this, bro. In America, right?
Uh-huh.
Right? Every single thing, like social consequences stem from legislation that has been passed. Example, there are long-lasting consequences from slavery. Like, Dr. Joy DeGroy, and you know what? How she, her doctor dissertation is about post-traumatic slavery that has happened to us. Redlining. Every single, like, economic predicament that our demographic finds ourselves in is a direct effect from legislation passed by the U.S. government. What I'm saying is before we can get on our, like, grind or whatever, the U.S. government has to correct these things that they've done to us.
They take you off the grind.
Why would they correct these things that they've done to us?
They're not going to do it willingly. You have to force them.
How are you going to force them to? You were just simple, saying we don't
bro.
Have the power.
Very simple, bro. You got to flip the script.
How you going to flip the script?
I see kind of what you're saying.
You got to flip the script. If you're in charge of capitalism.
If another one got into politics, you can flip the script.
They did that before. Then they end up selling us out.
No, not selling us out. They killed us. When
no, I think he's talking about black.
Yeah,
people.
I'm talking about it's people that still alive. That, yo,
black people.
I don't say no names, yo. You know Charles Ring was still alive, homie. Yeah, right. So what the powers? No, Colin Powell said.
Are in certain positions that don't fix things. For instance, let's say like if somebody like Jay-Z or Beyonce wanted to fund a certain amount of politics,
they fund Hillary Clinton. But hey, that's not my business.
Yeah, yeah.
Not,
I guess
spirit.
You know, I'm pretty sure. Don't you think?
Yeah, you know about that, right?
They can put a black person on one of us in certain seats.
And Obama was president, but hey.
I saw that video with that woman who was working for Hillary doing
yeah,
spirit.
Yeah, you saw that shit? It's weird, man.
Leave. It is. That's control. Some sick
leave,
shit.
Leave.
What is?
Spirit cooking.
You know what that is?
Spirit cooking. It's an occult practice that Marina, what's her name?
What is
Ambronovich, whatever her name is.
That works for Hillary.
What is it?
It's pretty much an occult ceremony that it's basically witchcraft, basically, like spells and stuff like that.
Spirit cooking.
Dark
what
witchcraft.
Do they do, like,
dark witchcraft, yeah.
What do they do in
if
the spirit cooking?
There's a blood sacrifice involving a child.
Yeah.
Yo, is there a garbage run?
So they like kill, oh, right outside, they killed it. They kill a kid or something?
Yes.
Well, like they simulate killing kids. They make fake bodies and then you show up to this the vast dinner and then you take body parts of this fake cadaver and you eat it. Yep.
Yeah, it's very sick.
Wait,
shit.
Because it's cooked. It's cooked like a it's presented on a plate. The kid is presented on a plate.
I bet you that's what they do on camera, but I bet you off camera is
it's crazy, son. Yo, man, I need some more soup. Hey, hold this. Yo, man, say what up to the people, dog.
Yeah. Come on, let's go.
What's up, everybody? You're about to get ready for this radio show. You already know. About to start in a couple of minutes. Stay tuned. I hope you will like our discussion inside the office. Now we're about to get to the real discussion. Well, the continuation.
So, cousin?
Yeah, please. Oh, hold on.
So peace. You know, y'all have been rocking with us for a while. You know, the show haven't started yet, but you know, we was having some good conversations, so we wanted to basically put it on air. So let us set up. You know, y'all just sit tight.
Laptop. You'll leave right there right now?
No, I'm put it right here. I'm getting ready.
What happened with Bella? Oh, she not coming? What happened with Bella?
I don't know.
Just, let's find a place to put this.
What's the empty? His laptop got to go there first.
Alright, and then we'll just put it on the laptop.
Yeah, man, yo, it's funny how, like, you know, we differ with political opinion, but we're in the same ballpark.
Yeah. No, but I agree with you, though. It's just that if it's going to fall, I'm going to let it fall, though.
Nah, man.
If we're not at the top and it's going to fall, I'm going to let it fall. I understand what you're saying.
If we fall, the consequences are going to be too much for us.
So we better make sure we win, then.
Bro, we won't win, dog.
I really don't want to say everything we're on the air. So say, for instance, if it collapses, what are we going to do? We're going to stay in the city?
We're fucked.
We're going to stay here?
We're screwed, bro.
Are we going to stay in the city?
What you mean stay in the city? For what, dog?
Exactly.
We're not going to be able to do anything here.
So we're going to leave, right?
What you mean?
We're going to leave, right?
Go where?
Not here.
Bro, we don't own anything. So, like, what are we going
to
do?
You don't have to own anything. It's mad land out there, bro.
Yeah, but, like, what are you going to do, though? You feel what I'm saying?
I'm gonna do what America taught me to do for 28 years.
Nah, bro. It's not gonna work, man.
How is it not gonna work?
It's not gonna work. And like, people have this fixation with guns, thinking, oh, well, if I have my gun, it's gonna save me. What you gonna do against a drone or something, bro? They got bombs that can destroy entire countries.
Well, who are you talking about, they, though?
The government, bro. If things were to collapse, the first directive of the government, this is actually a thing that will happen, is they will try to get control of the people.
Yeah.
Like, that's the first thing that will happen.
And the city's first, though, right?
Huh?
And the city's first.
The federal government.
They will go after major cities. New York, Chicago, Los Angeles.
They'll be everywhere,
Denver,
bro.
They will go after major cities.
They'll be everywhere. They'll be everywhere. Like, not just major cities. They'll be everywhere. Every town you can think of. Whatever. Every single person.
They don't have that much troops to do all that.
Bro, every single person beholden to law enforcement will be forced to follow this directive.
Nah, all of them won't.
Yep.
No, they won't. They all won't do
unless
this.
They quit and like help their people.
Yeah, exactly. And a lot of them will quit.
Nope. A lot of them are on this Blue Lives Matter stuff and blah, 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 blah. Protect and serve. And yeah, I do 6 tours a week kind of cops. Nah, bro. Can't trust cops.
6 tours a week.
Yeah, that's how they talk. Like they in a war or something. Yeah, man, my morning tour. Ask any cop. Morning tour. Black cops are the worst kind of cops. The worst kind of cops. Black cops, the worst. Yo, man, pass me headphones or whatever. Do you speak into the mics or not?
I got you, bro. I'm gonna get your headphones. Yo, listen, we need some. You have your music?
I got music.
On YouTube? Not yet?
No, not yet.
I think we gotta upload it on here, though. We need some music that we have copywritten, so we don't have to
That's perfect.
So we can post it.
Well, that's perfect.
Because all the other stuff, like, they could basically try to Yeah, there's basically copyright laws and infringement laws and whatnot.
Yeah.
Hmm. Oh, call him in here for this last mic, please, George. Call him in here for this last mic.
please, for this?
For the last mic, the third one.
Yo, can you help us with the last mic, the third mic?
What's happening?
You need help? Can I help with the third one, bro?
No. We're in the process of ordering more adapters. Somehow we lost a couple of adapters.
Oh, so you can't hook up this one?
I mean, you don't need the headphones to use the mic.
Oh, all right, but the mic is good.
Yeah, the mic is so good. Just press the third. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Press the third channel. All right. I thought about that. We're working on trying to make up for that.
It's cool, it's cool. Right. Thank you, dude.
Thank you, bro.
Bro, what's up? But you know you always do that and it never works?
Huh?
Nothing. You ready though?
I know.
What's that? That's the music?
Yeah.
Is what is it?
It's a freestyle though. I don't have copyright on it.
Let's play it. Put it up. No, you got SoundCloud, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, bro. Come on, you got SoundCloud. You do have it on here.
No, like, I don't have a SoundCloud account. I can email it to you, you can play it. I don't have none of that, bro. I'm not release my music, it's all good, bro. All right. That's how professionals do that. They don't just do shit.
Ready to start? Yeah. We gonna go back to that conversation though. Yeah, put it on speaker, bro. You ready though?
Yeah, I'm gonna put a face back in here too. In case this shit fucks up again.
Well, peace. You know, it's Thursday. We was off for the last two Thursdays.
Peace and love.
We was off for the last two Thursdays, you know. We had spring break, had to take care of some things. So we back today. You know, we back. Political Thoughts with George. I'm QP, the preacher, your co-host. And we have a guest star today, a special guest star. His name is Saints Barreau. He is the founder and the president of RECKLAW Hamilton Entertainment Company. He is Rebbe. What do you say? He knows a lot about politics, okay? So don't let the entertainment thing fool you.
It's not a game.
He's very into. He was actually having a conversation in the other room before, you know, we had to start the show. But we want to give him a chance to finish his point, all right? Bro, you know that's not Facebook Live, right? You say you was going to go on Facebook Live there.
No, that's coming right now.
Okay.
So, thanks for having me on the show. Appreciate y'all. Thanks for having me, everybody. I'm happy to be here. I'm always having spirited conversations with QP and George. These are both my guys from BCC days.
You already know.
We used to argue and stuff in the cut or whatever. So
the BCC days.
Basically, though, like. Talking to the mic like this. Alright, so basically just to get started, like I just want to start by saying all of these views held by all of us are very controversial, and we might really get into it over these airways, because we all essentially want the same thing for everybody. We want the same thing. The overall, pretty much, liberation from oppression of people of color. That's pretty much the key of what everybody wants. And it's just so many different paths to get there that sometimes we can lose sight about what's really important and what's not. Like, people don't understand that the basics of the political system, like who is president, who is governor, all these things matter. Despite what anybody will tell you, voting matters. Participating in the process matters. But not for the reason that you think it does. It doesn't matter to us because we've been conditioned to think that it doesn't matter to us. But everybody else participates in this process, but they tell us, yeah, everything's going to stay the same so y'all can stay home. Like, there's a reason for that.
So the conversation that we was actually having in the other room, we was talking about capitalism, right? And we had some opposing views. Well, it wasn't just capitalism. It was actually about what the topic is tonight. And we wanted to talk about the Facebook scandal with Mark Zuckerberg is going on right now. Actually, our President Trump, his dealings with the Russians, his deals with buying up companies to basically, I don't know, unethically cheat in the
campaign.
And
also, trying to fire the guy that's also working on his case.
Yeah, trying to fire the person that's working on his case. We was talking about this stuff. We got into capitalism. We started talking about how Trump wasn't, how he's not a good president for the country. You know, me, I was like, I don't care. He said for the world. So, James Monroe said for the world. I said I don't care because capitalism started on the backs of my ancestors, and capitalism have to go in the violent death, and it's going to have to go in the violent death.
Yeah, but the past is done. Like, that's done. There's nothing we can do to change that. Like, the only thing we should be focused on is how to fix it.
Shout out.
Make sure it doesn't ever happen again. Like, the Mark Zuckerberg scandal. So, like, let's start there, right?
Yeah, but so he's, he said the
pay. Right, I got it right here.
He got to finish what he was saying in the other room. You think so, though?
Well, like, this ties into what I'm saying in the room. So, there's an importance on who's in charge, again. And this scandal, at the very least, proves that. How so much was going through, like so much had to happen to elect this president. And for him to put his agendas forth. A lot of people who spent a lot of money felt that it was that important to go this length to do so. You want to introduce the scandal?
Yeah, so right now we're going to talk about why Michael Zuckerberg didn't want to talk about the data. So it says Mark Zuckerberg spent 10 hours testifying before Congress this week and still didn't answer the most important question about Facebook. That is, how much data does Facebook collect on users and non-users? So how much data is being collected from people talking about Facebook, all these little status people have, and all these, and Facebook has like so much things that, you know, like people talk about regular stuff, talk about politics, they talk about everything. So that's one of the things that we're going to talk about. So it also said it is a question about a various form of lawmakers in both the Senate and the House. But in most cases, Zuckerberg evaded it by proposing that his team follow up later. The closest that the Facebook CEO came to addressing the issue was when he was acknowledged to Republican Kathy Castor that Facebook collects data from users even when they're not even on Facebook.
And Google does the same thing, but
yeah, Google does the same thing too. Because when you sign into Google Mail and you search up how to make lasagna. Oh, how to brush your hair, how to do cornrows. What happened if you're doing, you know, like some other crazy shit, like, oh, how to roll a blunt, how to have sex with somebody, right? That's gonna be in your Google. That's gonna pop up in Google next time you go.
But we should know that already, though.
Yeah, people don't know that though.
I don't know.
People don't know how to go back on their privacy page. And they delete history, but all that stuff still saves in the cloud. That's why the government always have issue with Apple, because with Apple, the data is like it's encrypted.
Supposedly encrypted, but
you know, the government is always having issue with Apple, like the time when all this shit was happening, this terrorist shit was happening, when all this terrorist crap was happening, that they wanted to know, give us the information of who are these people are. Because some of them was, like, American citizens, but they was on some bull crap with,
I think the the ramifications from the Facebook scandal pretty much kind of shows you what happens when any entity that's not involved with the U.S. government gets influence on the level of the U.S. government. So basically, this scandal in terms of data, in terms of like, you know, like Facebook being the largest and most successful social network. In that regard, this is the first time this has ever happened. But whenever there is something introduced to the U.S. government in America that they do not have control over, they immediately want control over it. Facebook wouldn't be a problem if it was operated by the U.S. government. Nobody would have a problem with it.
But isn't that with all like these main countries though? What about China? Look at China and Google beef. They had the same problem though. Well, they couldn't control Google, so they kicked them out.
But China's communist though. We're a democratic republic. That shouldn't happen to us when we're the ones who elect the people who make the rules. And like we decide whether these people have jobs or not. Basically, I just feel like Mark Zuckerberg didn't understand how powerful he was in the scope of the world. He's basically the most influential person on the planet, whether he knows it or not. And when this Facebook scandal got out of hand, it's like the most valuable thing you can have on people is information.
That's the number one fact. Information and data is like the number one source now. It's because having data on somebody, that's like the new thing, hacking.
Blackmail
and data entry. Like if you know how to get data for some type of website or something like that, you are number one and gonna be on the list.
It's funny, Saints, bro.
I want to give you a shout out for actually admitting that this country is a democratic republic. You know, you don't hear too many people actually say that out loud. They still stuck on the fact that they think we live in a democracy.
No. We are not a democracy. We're a democratic republic. This whole notion that we are a democracy was like pretty much fed to us to make us feel like create a atmosphere of confusion because most people don't know why the Electoral College was put into place. Back in the days when people had to vote, right? When you voted, information wasn't disseminated the way it is today. It took a long time for people in California to learn what's going on in New York. Yeah. And like long time, like if something happened today, 2 weeks from now, it'd be in the press newspapers, they'll be talking about it. The Electoral College was pretty much, and at the time, a genius failsafe to like control the flow of information. So they're like, let's say the country got it wrong one time. The delegates were responsible for knowing like, okay, this person is this and this person is that. We can elect this person instead of this person. But now we've gotten to the point in our country, which is kind of crazy because we're not an old country, but we've outgrown this failsafe.
Because of social media and the internet. Right?
Not just social media, because of money. You can buy elections. Like elections aren't genuine anymore. Like you can go to a local congressman's seat. There can be three people running for that seat, and there can be two people who raise an honest $500,000 worth of fundraisers, and then there could be this person who's getting dark money or super PAC money who gets $2 million. Like, who do you think is going to win that race? Even if it doesn't matter how qualified the candidate is, that's not important. They're going to win that race regardless. Like grassroots campaigns, that stuff is cute and all that for the cameras and the commercials and stuff, but it's not a realistic thing anymore.
What's up? I don't know. I agree with you saying, but just because this is a capitalist system and everything is run on money, I don't think we actually have to follow that. If you run an honest grassroots campaign and the people see you, the people should honestly vote for you. But let's go back to this Mark Zuckerberg thing.
Yeah, so Mark Zuckerberg had to appear before Congress to pretty much justify Facebook's reckless and invasive use of data mining. And he kind of looked stupid. I felt like he wasn't prepared at all to sit in front of Congress and take it a step further. I don't think he realized how serious this was. And it's funny, like, everybody saw him, oh, he wore a suit. He must have been serious because, you know, this guy is a...
T-shirt wearing guy.
Yeah. Minimalist, actually. Minimalist. Word. He is. He doesn't rely on material things.
I admire that about him, though.
Yeah, but at the same time, he wore a suit, I guess, to, like, you know, recognize he was taking this idea seriously. One thing, basically, one part of this entire testimony stuck out to me was when there are two Trump supporters named Silk and Diamond. They're two black women. I'm not a fan of them, but they support Donald Trump. And one of the politicians were asking Mark Zuckerberg, so, like, who do you limit or who do you censor on Facebook? And he replied, terrorism. And they're like, yeah, but you censored Silk and Diamond's opinions. That's not terrorism. And he kind of stammered over his, He kind of didn't have a response. He wasn't prepared for it. And I'm telling you, it's because Mark Zuckerberg didn't understand how influential he was over the course of this, like, this entire thing. Facebook helped
this entire thing.
A guy cheat during the presidential election.
We're going to have to talk about that. I would like to introduce, though, one of our other guest stars. Right now, joining us, we have Miss Bella Matias, and she is the leader of the non-for-profit Urban Community Solutions. Bella, do you mind telling us about a little what you do?
No problem. So as QP already said, Quentin already said, I run Urban Community Solutions. It's a nonprofit that I started. So it's a nonprofit that organization that I started. Essentially, what we believe is that the way to solve the issues going on in the community is mainly through empowering the community by giving them the skills and the resources to be self-sufficient. So instead of them having to rely on different systems or different programs for the help that they need, we want to teach them the skills and give them at least the start of resources so that they can actually just provide for themselves. That's the gist of it. I can go more into it later on if you guys want to. So
that's dope, brother. Thank you. And we want to get into what you said about Facebook helped them cheat on the campaign. That was very interesting. But before we go there, do you have anything else to add to the Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook scandal?
Yes, definitely. So he made a comment that he said he doesn't realize how influential he is, and I think that's an incorrect statement. No offense, but this guy is a brilliant man. He knows how influential he is. You know, he didn't get to where he is by not, you know, seeing the bigger picture, by not seeing 10, 20 steps ahead, you know. So he's strategic. You know, his whole Facebook platform is based on different algorithms. That's how Facebook operates. So to think that he doesn't know what he's doing, he definitely knows what he's doing. The question is, what's his agenda? That's the real question. The real question is, what is his agenda and who is he aligned with and who is he not aligned with?
Yeah, but, like, how do you explain his gaffe in front of the Congress then? Like, he literally appeared before them, and they asked him questions, and yeah, they were trying to basically, they grilled him, trying to get him to justify some of the things he was doing. And he was coming up short. Like for a man who is painted as a genius and, you know, 20 steps ahead, it didn't seem like he was 20 steps ahead. It seemed like he didn't understand why these people were upset with him.
Well, all geniuses don't actually have speaking personalities, though. I don't really see Mark Zuckerberg speak that much in public. But you did pose a good question, I think, which goes back to Saints Barrow question. You had asked, who is he aligned with, though? Like, what is his motive? What is his agenda?
Right.
And who is he aligned with? So we're going to go back to that question. Mr. Georgie, you have anything to add?
Nah, I was just asking, going to keep on reading what I have prepared here.
Before we go into that question?
Yes.
Okay.
So, so like you were saying about the extra Facebook data collection is ultimately the core concern of Facebook business, and the company that brings in $40 billion in advertisement revenue annual, because it offers brands data that gives them an unparalleled ability to target customers. If Facebook stops collecting this data, it wouldn't undermine its entire business model, the business model. Also, though that the hearing with Zuckerberg repeatedly sought that dispel the notion that Facebook sells users' data.
Hey, well done.
It doesn't, but it does trade off users' data. Harvesting the data and using it to target ads more effectively than its competitors is how Facebook makes the book of its money.
Why do you think me saying Facebook helped Donald Trump cheat in this election is wrong?
I didn't say it was wrong. I said it was very interesting.
Interesting?
Yeah.
Why do you think it's interesting?
Because this is a capitalistic country. It basically has been since the exception. So, anything that they do, like, with a capitalistic mindset, I don't think it's cheating. And, like, the way this country was founded, it may be unethical, but the way this country was founded was unethical.
Well, that's a fair point. But the reason why I feel this way is because I feel like, for the most part, people don't understand the magnitude of what it means that Donald Trump became the president. Like, number one, this is the first time ever a man who's never had public office was elected president. It's number one. Like, that's never happened before, ever. Like, and that wasn't even thought possible. Like, people who run for president are people who've been in government for years and decades. Like, you know, like, even Barack Obama being a junior senator then running for president was even kind of looked at like, oh, this guy have what it takes. And Donald Trump never held any kind of office. He doesn't understand anything about the political process. And this is something that's reaffirmed where, like, you can go on Google and type in pictures of some of his cards that he reads for his notes, and it has, like, very simple things on it, like, remember to smile, listen to people. This is a real thing. Like, this man is president. Like, this has nothing to do with political affiliation. Like, people don't know my political beliefs. They don't know if I'm liberal or conservative. I'm basically saying, like, this man, Donald Trump, one of the richest men in the world, regardless how you feel about it, he is, because there's no way you run around in a 747 Boeing jet and you ain't balling out of your mind. Like, I don't know how much that costs to maintain that. This man is one of the most rich men in the world. He sat in a room full of capable people, and he said, oh, I want to be president of the United States, and they made it happen for him. That's literally what happened.
You know what's crazy? Hold on. You know what's crazy? Like, today, in my presidency class, you know, we talk about different kind of presidents. We talk about different presidents in my presidency class, and we was talking about Truman, but we was talking about my professor said one thing about John Adams. He said that anybody could be president, any normal could be president, and that's the case here. Like, Donald Trump is a normal guy. And this guy is like...
He's not a normal guy.
Nothing normal about Donald Trump, man.
Well, to me, he's a normal guy. He's just a little sick in the head.
A little sick? The man is a sociopath. I'm not diagnosed to say this, but this man has no empathy, feeling, or remorse. If you even look at his history, if you look at how he got to where he was, he's got to where he was by screwing over people as much as possible. Like, the carnage that he left in Atlantic City, there are business people who are still feeling the effects of that.
That's what capitalism is all about, though.
No.
Yes, it is. That's how capitalism started, and that's how capitalism will always be.
We have a president that only thinks about himself, though. Like, he doesn't think about the world. He just thinks about himself.
So, I just want to interject. It's kind of basically agreeing with what you said about that being capitalism and that being what it always is and what it always be. You said he's a sociopath, but I would argue that everyone who is a multi-millionaire or multi-billionaire is a sociopath, because if you have that much money, you have way more than you will ever need, and you have other people starving in the world, dying in the world, and you're not only willing to allow that to happen, but you're willing to further perpetuate it just to increase your wealth when you don't need any more than you already have. They're willing to, you know, start wars, do all these things, kill millions of innocent people just to increase the billions that they already have. So I would argue that they're all psychopathic or sociopathic in a sense. They're megalomaniacs, essentially. So
you think it varies in degrees, though?
What does that matter, though?
A spectrum? If this was benefiting us, would we feel the same way about it?
If this is benefiting me, I don't need to oppress people, though. Like,
no, okay.
I've never thought I need to have all of this such security that I would just let people starve. Like, I would try to help people. If they don't want my help, it's a different story.
All right, so again, this leads to the conversation that we were having before we got here, right? Capitalism is not inherently evil. It's a tool, a mechanism. It's a system that the people who are in charge of it are maybe inherently evil. Whoa. But it is a system, nonetheless. It can work for people like us if we think to get to that point it work for us.
All right, here's my thing with that. Ideally, right, like in a perfect world, right, then you could look at the capitalist system at its very basic, essential you know, like if you just look at the definition, it could work, right? By definition, what it is, right? It's just supposed to be free, open market, right?
Right.
Okay, that's what it's supposed to be. But the system is already rigged at this point. We're at a point where they've put so much in place that it's basically like playing dice with loaded dice, right? You're going to lose because it's set up for you to lose at this point. Now, if you stripped capitalism down to the bare bones and put in enough regulations that this couldn't happen, that would be a different story. But we're already past that point because we're already at a point where it's already so heavily weighed in their favor that the system is just, it's broken, it's corrupted at this point. Do you see what I'm saying?
So, like, you don't think there's any way that the paradigm could shift and like, we can emerge on top? Because
We can.
I believe we can.
I believe that you can. We can as well. But, like, we were saying, in a room, we were talking politically minded. Poetically minded had actually said that the system that you're talking about, the system that we agree on, is not. It won't be capitalism anymore. It will be a mix of capitalism and socialism, basically. Because actually, we would be on top, and we would be sharing the wealth that we have. So it wouldn't be 100% capitalism.
But I mean,
people that you're talking about right now, the people that we're actually talking about on the show, they're 100% capitalism.
So, like, I would argue that we're already at that point. So, like, and we've been there ever since FDR's New Deal. Like, where we started incorporating actual national agendas with, like, socialist ideas. Like, yeah, helping mass a lot of people based on the federal government, yeah.
They give us things to pacify us.
No, it's not, yeah. but
They give us scraps, and then, this is so great.
In terms of ideology. Like, before that happened, that was firmly rejected in this country. Before that happened, it took us having the economic crisis that almost destroyed the country for us to get to that point, to even allow that leeway of people. You know what? The federal government should have a role in supporting its people. So we're already at that point right now. So what I'm saying is, like, if back then, which was perpetually more conservative than what it is today, right? Back then, like, there's a point in this country where people thought that saying slaves or black people were equal to whites was progressive. So now we're in 2018, we're way more liberal, way more allowing in this country. So if we can get to the point where we can allow that little leeway of socialism ideology to exist within this country, then we can take that a step further. We're already at that balance, that mix of capitalism and socialism. We're already there.
But all they've done is change the narrative, right? So like, we're free now, but like, you have wage.
No, we're not free. We're not free. No, it's not free.
I mean, you just said that we went from slavery and having them say, you know, having the phrase that whites and blacks were equal was progressive and radical and things like that.
That was considered progressive and radical.
Right, of course. And you're saying it's better now. I would argue it's not better now at all. They've just become more deceptive about it, right? So it's socially unacceptable to say these things. It doesn't mean that that what they do systematically to us has changed at all. You know, they've just found a different way to package it.
Saints Row, I'm happy that you actually brought up the black question. I didn't really want to bring it up. But
you always bring it up.
You brought it up.
I always bring it up.
I wanted to bring up more of the socialism. The socialist program.
Yeah, New Deal. That's what I wanted to, too. Because you brought up blacks, and then you brought up the New Deal as well, right? But we know that when the New Deal came out, even though like black and colored people, they probably benefited from it. Didn't benefit from it a lot, though.
No.
The New Deal, it actually helped Western Europeans out more than it did to the people that were living here for hundreds of years. So these people, they didn't even have job security. Also, the New Deal, it kept out Mexican Americans who have been here since thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of years, and it also kept out Native Americans. So the New Deal wasn't even for any of the people that's in this room right now, and it wasn't for the 1%.
I was saying in terms of ideology.
But even when you talk about the systems that's up now, you talk about the public assistance thing, right? The whole benefits program of the federal government, it is used to keep the man out of the household.
Yeah,
you understand?
Yeah.
So you're breaking up families of the poor people anyway.
Look.
So the ideology is not really ideology. It's covert warfare, so, like Brother Matthias was saying. So it's not really socialism, though. It's covert warfare.
Both of y'all are absolutely correct. I was saying in terms of the powers that be and in terms of the way that they think.
But like, they give it to us for deceptive means.
I wasn't talking about like the effect that it has on people of color. That's a different conversation. I was saying how back then, the things that they consider to be radical or progressive are things that are normal now.
I think the New Deal was the Trojan horse.
I don't think the New Deal was a Trojan horse, because actually the New Deal actually got us out of the depression also.
While people were in a depression. You don't know with Black Wall Street, you know how many communities across the nation that we had like that?
So, like, we're touching on...
We weren't allowed to go in the banks. We built our own banks. So, my people were in the Great Depression. So, when you talk about the Great Depression, who are you exactly talking about? Because you're not talking about my people.
Yeah, because we weren't allowed to do that. Yeah,
you're right. Well, we weren't allowed to do that, but we was all in the Depression
My people were not in the Great Depression. Just let me let that be clear.
We were affected by it, but we were not in it.
We were in it, but we were highly affected by it, though.
No.
Yeah, because they came and burned down our communities.
Couldn't vote. And like couldn't own property for like a plethora of reasons, states law, all those other stuff.
Grandfather clause.
Yeah, so like we weren't really a part of the governing body at that point. Quentin is right, but what I'm saying is this: you can say that, and you're absolutely right. But this country has shown examples of times where it can take a not accepted demographic, and literally over a span of time, turn it into a norm, a thing that they accept. There's a point in time I have a million examples. Several demographics of immigrants that came in to this country.
Look, that was to control the native population. That was
Look,
not only that, but it's cheap labor, right? Yeah. Like, so it's about labor force,
it's
right?
It's about class system.
Okay, right now, hold on, because you mentioned immigration, so let's talk about it. So first of all, right now in California, because Trump has been deporting so many people, the Californian people are begging Trump to stop deporting people because they're losing so much in labor that they need, because no one else wants to take those jobs in the fields for that little bit of pay, that actually they're saying that fruit is going to die on the vine and on the trees because nobody's going to pick it, okay? Because nobody's willing to take that pay. So when you talk about, immigration and they're accepting this and that, no, they're not. They're exploiting people.
That's a class system.
They're exploiting people. They're like, let's bring them in so we can have cheap labor.
Okay, so
it's not to help people.
I'm not worried about exploiting people. So, I need to refine my answers more.
But after this, we go back to the campaign.
All right, so, look, you're like, we're going to get into it, right? This is going to get real controversial, right? We're going to get into it. So, all right, socially, a demographic that wasn't quite accepted before, but now is. The most recent example I can think of is the LGBT community. So, pretty much, this country has shown us that they can take somebody or who, again, I'm not comparing struggles. I'm saying somebody who was a demographic that was taboo at first, and now it is socially acceptable. The narrative about them has changed, and it's changed in every single arena. It's changed in terms of thinking about business. It's changed in a political system, in entertainment. They are universally accepted now. It is taboo to look down upon them, and it's taboo for somebody to say anything negative about them. You get what I'm saying?
I think that was a Trojan horse too, but I'm just going to
say that. No. So do I. But I think there's an agenda behind that.
I'm not going to talk more about that. I don't want to get people stirred up and have a fight.
Look, agenda or not, the results is very, very clear. They, over the span of a few decades, have become more socially acceptable than people of color.
The question is, why has that been allowed?
But it doesn't matter.
Go back to the campaign.
No, wait, hold on.
We're deferring from the actual topic.
All I'm saying is, the country is showing an ability to do that. That provides hope for people. It provides hope for the system.
I disagree too. I think there was an agenda. I think there's an agenda behind that.
You said that the Facebook helped cheat on Trump's campaign.
Yeah. Yes. I fully agree.
So actually, Mark Zuckerberg, he actually admitted to funding his campaign on live. It was live from Congress. He admitted that. He helped fund Trump's campaign, but when they answer him about trade liquidity,
but there's nothing wrong with him helping fund Trump's campaign.
Yeah, because he was like, fund a lot of campaigns, so yeah. it's nothing about it. But the thing was about the
interference
of the data of the inter get rid of the people that control the data and everything about how they like hacked it and everything like and like put more votes to Trump and like with the data.
So
we can take more about that.
So look, so like here's my understanding of what happened. Right, Mark Zuckerberg isn't directly responsible for anything that Facebook did to help Donald Trump. Because, again, as you pointed out before, Facebook is run on algorithms. What Mark Zuckerberg is responsible for is, like, when he became aware that there was a problem, that a foreign entity was, like, literally buying propaganda spots targeting its specific blocks of people.
What foreign entity?
Russia.
Okay.
This has been documented as proof. It's no longer, like, allegations. There have been Russian agents that have been indicted through the Mueller investigation. This is a fact now. Like, a foreign entity tampered within our political process. And not only did they want Donald Trump to be president, they wanted to make sure that anybody else who was running against Donald Trump had the hardest time. They, like, every single intelligence agency we have has supported this. And they were saying this back in the late stages of Obama's presidency. When Mark Zuckerberg became aware of this, he did nothing to stop it.
That doesn't seem illegal to me. It seems like,
what do you American mean it doesn't way? Seem illegal though? Yeah. How's that American way when it's another country?
But first of all, Mark Zuckerberg's not a politician. He's a businessman, yeah. Right? So like if you pay me X amount of dollars, what do I care?
And I'm not breaking the law,
right?
So.
Like exactly. That's so I'm making my money.
So why is he sitting in front of Congress if it's not?
Maybe they butt hurt. I don't know. That's what I'm saying.
I mean, they pulled him in. They have the right to do that.
They pulled him in because they think he's part of the scandal. They think because of since he's the CEO of Facebook, even though he doesn't control a whole entire Facebook, he has other employees to control Facebook.
I don't think he was unaware.
No,
he's the CEO. He wasn't unaware.
No,
but let's be real.
He knew what was going on.
He knew, but he didn't.
He chose not to get involved.
He didn't know the half part. He didn't know, the top to bottom.
Why is he obligated to care about? He's here to make his money.
All right, so, again, that is an acceptable excuse if you're running, like, a fast food chain or you're running a record label. But Mark Zuckerberg is running the most influential company on the planet right now outside of Google. You can argue that Facebook is more influential
than
Google.
And Amazon.
Yeah, and Amazon. Bezos. Yeah, one of the top three things, and that exceeds government. So, like, again... Russia, right? So Russia interfered with our campaign. We all understood election. We all understood something's going on because there were Russian agents who were indicted on this count.
Okay, so like they did something illegal. They bought American companies. That's illegal now.
No, what you mean? No. It's not illegal. People are paying for the consequences of what happened.
I don't understand what they did wrong though. That's what I'm saying.
They
seemed like the capitalist way. Like,
no, it's not the capitalist way.
You don't buy companies to influence what you want?
No, it was fake news, propaganda. They're feeding these people things that aren't real, getting them out to go out and vote.
But America, like, sends us propaganda all the time.
It's very different.
They taught me in my generation that we were supposed to be gangsters and sell crack to our family. That we were supposed to abuse women. That's what America taught me. I don't understand how it is that Russia can send out fake news propaganda and it's illegal for them to do it, but it's not illegal for our.
You think Russia cares about the black struggle?
No, I'm not saying that.
So, like, do you think them interfering somehow benefits us?
Do you think America cares about the black struggle?
No, they don't. But I'm asking you, like...
So you're saying I gotta pick a side between...
No. Not pick a side. What I'm saying is this is an attack on all of us because the consequences of it is going to affect all of us. Like, Russia's not going to be like, oh, the black Americans are... Oh, they had it enough, so we're going to leave them out of that. No, we're Americans in their eyes. Like, it doesn't matter how we feel about it. We're Americans in their eyes. And, number two, you have to understand, like... After this whole entire thing happened, right? So, like, let's look at what happened after that. The national security advisor, 2 months into a presidential administration, is forced to resign. Later is arrested and takes a plea deal. The campaign manager of the president-elect, now president, like, literally gets arrested and is pleads guilty. Rick Gates gets arrested, pleads guilty. Why? The FBI just raided Trump's personal lawyers. Office. The FBI just raided his office. Like, let's understand. Yes, laws are being broken. This is not a, like, shrug your shoulders kind of thing.
I think I get what QP is saying, so I just want to kind of put it out there. I think the way that QP is saying, and I agree with you, is, like, you're asking us to choose between oppressors. Like, which oppressor, like, do you side with? And it's like, it doesn't really make sense. Like, what difference does it make?
No,
like, what difference, is like it, what difference does it make if Russia's interfering, right? Like, what, in the election where neither of the candidates that were the front runners give a shit about the black and brown people. Sorry. The black and brown struggle, right? If Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, we know neither one of them care about the struggle of people of color, then what difference should it make to us if Russia interfered? Because at the end of the day, it's just all a bunch of oppressors. We shouldn't really be concerned with what they're doing. We should be concerned with what we're doing to actually fix our people.
Because I'm just gonna have to learn Russian if they take over. No, have to learn Chinese and Chinese come
over. Because
look, they forced my family to learn English.
It's gonna be the red dawn. Look, red dawn all over again.
Look, it's important because when you really break this down, Russia attacking us, the first people in any kind of negative thing that happens to this country, any fallout that happens, we're going to be the first people to feel the effects of it. Like, when businesses start closing down, the people who's affected by it first is black people.
So black people should start building their own businesses.
We can't affect the political process if it doesn't exist. We can't, we cannot get our part of it if it don't exist.
But okay, so if it collapses, what, in my opinion, what we should be doing right now is be preparing ourselves to be ready for when it does inevitably collapse. I could tell you how. So basically, it goes a lot to certain things QP was saying and certain things that I mentioned with what I'm trying to do with my organization is by building up our communities now to be self-sufficient, right? So if we get to a place where we can autonomously operate without what they have to offer, by having our own things to offer, by building up our own skills, our own resources, our own sustainability, right? Our ability to
our own things, our own
to survive as a community on our own, right? Then when it collapses, because what happens when anytime any government collapses or anything major happens, there's a void, right? And now whoever is ready is going to fill that void.
And so you were saying in the other room, in the other conversation,
I'm glad you brought this up.
Economists, yeah. You were saying that the economists predicted that this might be the year.
Economists were talking about how, like, you know, retail was in 2022, retail was going to start going through this epic collapse. But we're starting to see it as early as 2018.
Yes.
Now, to your point,
I
110% agree that we need to have our communities be self-sufficient. This is something that me and QP talk about all the time. We're always saying that. But we don't have any commodities that we can build our communities off of.
And that's why you do group economics and you get people pool their resources together so you can start purchasing land. Because we might not have financially the means, but like numbers-wise, population-wise, we outnumber them.
Yeah,
in the urban cities, not everywhere, in the urban cities, we do outnumber them. So now if we pooled our resources together and started buying land and started buying resources, little by little, we could gain commodities.
But look, here's the thing. Here's part of the oppression package, I call it, that like that's been lumped on our shoulders. We are the largest consumers in this country.
No, we accepted on our shoulders.
No, we didn't accept it.
Yeah, we picked it up.
No, we didn't accept it at all. It was forced on us.
We just took it.
Look. We're the consumers in this country. We're the largest consumers in this country.
Oh, yeah. Like
Black Friday comes, we're the ones spending the most amount of money on everything. Tax season comes, we're the ones giving money back to corporations. We're not putting it in our pockets. Like we're all conditioned to feel
and
this.
That's
way.
Why we gotta but educate our people wait, financially.
Wait. But look, there's more. Look.
All right.
It's like people can't get past this idea that like being consumers gives us power. It does to a degree, but it doesn't because we don't own anything. Like these people who apply group economics, right? Example, there's people in my neighborhood. Like I recently came to my attention that there's one demographic of people who owns all the buildings in my neighborhood.
Who are they?
The Albanians. They own all the buildings in my neighborhood. All the apartment buildings.
They own some they of the own buildings in my building and my black
fault
is that?
It's their
and
fault.
And Jewish
because,
people.
It's who's fault?
Because they come into this country with resources already. And,
oh, that's
No.
They don't come with resources here.
Do you know Albanian history?
Bro, listen. I'm talking about in 2018.
when they come over here, their cousin owns something. They're like, hey, look, I want you to run this because I got this. They're like, okay, cool. And then they do the same thing for their cousin and brother. And
there's no reason
we can't.
But
you were just saying, yeah,
we don't own anything. We don't own anything.
There's no reason that we can't engage in that.
But that doesn't come with, that's not coming with resources. That's like a resource that was already here that they established.
Okay, but here's the thing,
but you just said that we have the big.
Sorry.
You said we are the biggest consumers in this country, right?
Yeah.
What did you say? You said we buy all this stuff. What I heard you say is that we are the reason why we bomb every country on the planet. Because without our money, this system would fail. That's what I heard you say. So when we take our money out the system and create our own nation, our own system, however you want to call it, we keep the political system the same.
Nah, man.
We create our own system.
Because that's not how it works.
Their system will fall.
What we need to do is boycott the jobs, boycott retail. Boycott everything that we buy from them, and then
food and books,
right?
and then start spending on our own businesses, on black owned business, Latino owned businesses, brown owned businesses. Right, that's it. That's how we kill the government because, like, if we can,
that's a blanket.
That killed the government.
I don't know this guy.
What I meant to say was
that's a blanket solution. That's not look. The money that we have, right, as consumers, this doesn't apply to. The money that we have as consumers, right, we are given just enough money to buy things that we don't need, but not enough money to buy things that we do need.
That sounds like BS.
No, it's not BS.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not BS. Yo, like, we can Google this right now. Look, demographics of black business owners in America. See how many of them are doing well.
That's going to be by economists that were taught in European systems.
But compare them to everybody else in the country, though. It's undisputable.
Let me interject really quickly. You just said that we are the biggest consumers in the nation, right?
Yes.
So now, if we're collectively spending the most money in the nation, what's preventing us from collectively taking that money and instead of spending it in little items, getting together and be like, yo, we need to buy some land here. We need to buy this. We need to buy that. Right? So we're already collectively spending the most. The only difference is we're spending on petty stuff instead of coming together and taking that same money and putting it into things that we...
But it's not petty stuff. Like, the things
it
that...
Is.
No,
it is.
The things,
it absolutely is.
The things that we have to buy are, like, contingent on our lifestyles currently in this
our
country.
Our lifestyles? Like what?
It was like that. Buy Jordans and...
Buy the new
iPhone.
That's part of it. Jordans, iPhones, stuff like this, right? So, like, again,
screen TVs.
Here's the hustle. The whole world that we live in is set up to operate where these things are basically short of a requirement. Like, you're at a disadvantage if you don't have a laptop in college. You're at a disadvantage. Like, I don't care what nobody says.
You're
at a disadvantage if you don't have a cell phone in 2018.
Obama phones.
You have Obama phone, you have the laptops USG.
There's so much that you don't have access to if you don't have that.
But people take it to an extreme, right? Like, people want a new one every year. You don't need a new phone every year. Let me tell you something. Right now, my phone, I have for like a year and a half. People buy new phones every 6 months. And the only reason I have this for such a short time is because my other one broke, okay? Right? My laptop, I've had my laptop for 4 years. 4 years.
Is it a MacBook?
People go and buy them every 2-3 years or whatever.
Is it a MacBook?
Yeah, my laptop's a MacBook.
I had this Mac since I graduated.
You know how I knew that you had a MacBook when you said you have 4 years? Because, again, look, you have to fall into the staples. MacBooks are meant to last you 6 to 10 years. Like, you already fell for the trap once you bought it. Like, they don't need you to buy another MacBook again. Like, look.
They get you to charge it.
Listen. Consumerism.
Honestly, that's bull because, first of all, I paid $1,000 for my laptop. I've had it for 4 years already. So right now, I've paid $250 a year for my laptop, and it's still going.
Apple is one of the most successful businesses in the world.
That's because most people continue to buy new ones and new ones and new ones. Every time a new iPhone drops, people go get it and run by it. I'm not in that category, right? So what I'm saying to you is you're saying, oh, these things are essential. Yes, they're essential, but not in the frequency which we purchase them. Okay, if you buy a laptop and then you want a new one next year because a new one came out, and a new phone next year because a new one came out, now it's not a necessity. Now you're just perpetuating the cycle. You understand what I'm saying?
No.
It's a difference from necessity and what we're doing and the way we're consuming.
I partly agree with you.
What I'm saying is,
it's difficult.
It's difficult.
But, like, again, it's hard again. Like I just saw this quote like from Martin Luther King in that new documentary HBO. He said it's very cruel to tell a man to pull himself up by his bootstraps if he doesn't have boots on, right? So every single person, right? I guarantee you, if you was to get everybody in the room, we'd be like, all right, cool. Don't buy that new iPhone. Don't buy those new clothes. Don't buy that this. Let's all get together and get some land. The first things you will hear is, wait, but I need to take care of my family. Oh.
But you said don't buy a new iPhone, though. What did I do taking care of your family?
What you mean? Did the family don't need an iPhone?
No, my family don't need an iPhone.
Oh, it's like nobody needs a smartphone?
No.
If you get an EBT card or Medicaid, you can get an Obama phone.
They got the house phone and they got my iPhone. Smartphone?
Yeah, they have smartphones.
I don't know.
The new Obama phones are smartphones now.
It's touchscreen and everything.
Yep,
they would say, oh, look, man, I need clothes. That's what they would tell you.
You could go to like the local church or something. They give you Michael Kors.
But people will tell you.
Those are excuses. Because even if you wanted to buy clothes, like people even go overboard with that. How many outfits do you need?
They don't really need a lot of
outfits. You don't need a lot of outfits. You can wash it and wear. But people want to front. People want to stunt. People want to be on Instagram, this, that, whatever, whatever, to show off and to have a certain lifestyle. And it's not necessary. Look at Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs is wearing the same outfit every day.
It's hard to compare.
Hold on. He will wear a t-shirt and jeans, black turtleneck t-shirt and jeans every day. And he's wearing the same clothes, basically. I'm sure it wasn't the same exact outfit, but he probably had a couple of them. But literally, he didn't care about a style or perpetuating image or anything like that. And this guy's a multi-billionaire, right? And this is the mindset that they have versus the mentality that we have, which they fed to us.
So, like, you don't think consumerism forces people to become dependent on it? You don't think so?
Absolutely. Yeah, and you have to wake up from consumerism and break out of that, because you can easily change your mentality and be like, I'm not part of this.
Not easy.
It is easy. Because it's just about changing the mentality. It's not easy in the sense that not everyone is psychologically aware of what's going on, and you're constantly being bombarded. So you might not realize, like, what's making you behave this way, right? Not everybody is that psychologically aware. Let's be realize our privilege that we're all college students and we're all in a place of higher education, and we all have the privilege to expand our minds and take the time to think about these things and politic and talk and all of that. Not everybody has that privilege. Some people are day-to-day just trying to survive.
Yeah.
And so when you're in survival mode, you're not really thinking about much. So it's easy to get caught up in that trap. But if we can awaken the minds, it is easy to change.
I'm in survival mode right now, but the thing is that I don't want to be in survival mode forever. So
I mean,
I'm
going to
build.
You understand what I'm saying?
No, the thing is that I
survival mode meaning you don't even have the privilege to go to school.
I can see your point.
Right, you understand what I'm saying?
I'm like 90% with you. Like, no lie. Like, I understand. Me and him, you can like support this. Like, we have these kind of conversations all the time. Like building sustainable wealth. And like literally teaching others that look like us how to do the same. That's the end goal, and it should be. My argument is like, again, back to the initial point. If all of this system breaks, we don't have the opportunity anymore. We lose that opportunity because we don't have anything to fall back on.
We could build on what we know.
Yeah, but like we're competing with people who have way more than we do.
Who? What people are you talking about?
Are you serious?
Yeah, tell me.
People who don't allow us to exist. Like, nobody thinks it's weird that, like, that the richest, like, people of color in this country exist in basically one field, which is entertainment. Like, nobody thinks that's weird.
Yeah,
how,
weird.
Like it's rare that you find an American person of color who's an oil tycoon or who's a tech tycoon. That's a really big industry that we're basically not allowed to be a part of.
American.
There are so many, like, things that we don't have a part of. Like, Silicon Valley, the internet is basically the newest commodity that the world has that people have ownership of. We don't have any parts of this.
Yeah, I mean,
this country, you're right.
Let's think about it though. So the buy-in to those kind of businesses is huge, right? Because these are already multi-billion established industries, right? So the only people, and starting off, we typically don't have the resources as we were talking about before, right? The only people that probably do have those resources are the people who came up maybe through the entertainment industry, and they're not of that mindset, unfortunately, to start doing these things. I mean, hopefully at some point that will change. I think there's starting to be a shift where, you know, you're having some celebrities try to enter to different fields or whatever.
Yeah, there are some celebrities that are trying to branch off, like, you know, like, well, there's like a lot of celebrities that are doing this. Like Rihanna, she got perfume and clothing.
Yeah, but
and
that's, no, no, but that kind of stuff is still consumerism. Not important.
Yeah, it's consumerism. Consumerism, but I know what you're talking about. Like,
yeah,
you're talking about like a super PAC.
Akon.
Yeah,
Akon is one of those people. Akon provided electricity for. One place in Africa, no. They was
that's because
in Ghana.
No, but that's what he was talking about, though.
But
he
that's
was saying
America's not.
You're right. You're right. But that's what he was saying. Basically, like in this country, people of color, the only way they can go, the only way they can thrive, is in entertainment.
Like we don't have anything else.
If you go to South America, you go to Africa. There's a lot of You see a lot more millionaires,
like
and millionaires
engineers
of color
and stuff like that
are in the energy field and technology field and whatnot. But in
on
America,
the forefront of all,
we're
of
not
all
really
industries.
Allowed to raise in those fields. Only entertainment.
And to like even bring it back to education, like this whole again, like I'm saying, it's like I understand what you're saying. But in order for us to get to this point where we can be self-sustaining, again, like STEM majors, do you know how many, like how it's a crisis for people of color trying to graduate with STEM major degrees. It's like, it's so low, the percentage. It's embarrassing almost. It's like the only person I know who has a STEM degree and it's like actually doing something in their career, it's my cousin. That's it. He's a teacher. Like,
there's a couple of people in STEM.
I mean, there's
by percentages. Look it up.
Whoa. There's also incentives for it now that they're trying to put into place. So, like, if you're a minority, there are like stipends and certain things, or like.
But for every one of us, there's a thousand of some other people.
Okay, but you have to. So first of all, you have to understand. Like, let's think about it. We're way behind education-wise. Period. Right?
Yes.
Well, we will go back to the campaign thing.
After. Yeah, we do have to go back.
Yeah, we're far.
But like, we're way behind in education. Period. So for us to get into the STEM fields, which are you know, the science, time, technology, yeah. engineering, mathematics, like, these are some of the most advanced, challenging fields that there are. So you trying to take people who are from, like, coming from subpar education to begin with, because that's what they give us in our public schools in comparison to the affluent neighborhoods, and wonder why they're not in the STEM fields. Well, there's no wonder why they're not in the STEM fields. They're not in the STEM fields because we're being put behind, you know, we're being put behind from the beginning.
In the gaming system.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. But going back to the campaign, though, we was talking about how Facebook basically helped Donald Trump cheat. I don't...
Long story short, it's very complicated to bridge that together, but yeah, long story short.
You should have talked more about that data and controlling.
All right, so there's a data firm called Cambridge.
Yeah, Cambridge.
Analytica, right? So recently, the CEO actually stepped down due to the whole Facebook scandal. Because people are starting to like go deeper into it, and basically, there's a TED Talk video of the CEO was bragging about how he can use this new interface and technology to like you know properly identify political bases, and pretty much feed them the exact information they would need to galvanize them to come out and to vote. So that scandal blew back on this guy, and again, this entire thing. comes to find out that Cambridge Analytica was hired by the Donald Trump campaign for this very specific just goal of feeding false information to people to get them out to vote for Donald Trump. Now, mind you, now, look, there's a lot going on because that is a very small part on why Donald Trump won because, again, he did lose the popular vote.
He like, lost the popular vote, but he also had all the racist people and people that never even vote.
No, because
vote for him
basically
now.
What happened was, this Cambridge Analytica, it pretty much was a fan, like fanning this fire that was like pretty much stoking,
putting gasoline on the fire.
Yeah, ever since Obama was elected, all the racist people were like, whoa, this is too much change, and we need to like address this immediately. And regardless of how black people feel about it, Obama is still one of us when they look at him. They don't look at him as a white guy. Any kind of white guy describes Obama as a black person. They don't even count the fact that he's half white. That doesn't even come up in conversation, to be honest with you. They see him and go, oh, he's not American, blah, blah, blah. When they saw that, even if they didn't even understand how intricate it was about him being president or his policies, they knew that, like, before 2008, it was impossible for one of them to be in the White House. And now, I'm looking at a two-term black president. Something's going on in this country. We need to take it back. So this data firm is directly responsible for fanning that flame directly. Like, people need to understand, when you have false information in the Democratic Republic, like pertaining to the political process, that is dangerous. It's a president that can't be allowed, but whether or not it's legal.
Is it legal?
It doesn't matter. Like,
Now we're stopping people from doing things that are not legal.
How is that a justification for anything?
Well, Trump is.
Is it legal?
Right now, Trump is being like.
There's so many things that are legal. There's so many things that are legal that are not good. Like,
yeah, you're right. Slavery was legal. So was the Holocaust.
Exactly.
But going back to what you're saying, so now
alcohol is legal. You know how bad that is for people.
But you say you're for the political system.
Yes.
But then you're saying that we should get rid of somebody that didn't do anything illegal against the political system. That didn't do anything against the political system.
No.
So I'm trying to see, like, how does this work, though? Like, so, like, are we picking and choosing our battles?
No.
And then, I mean, not to take you off,
what's
but
the standard?
And then at the same time, we're going after Trump because he's the president. But then, what about Hillary winning the DNC? We don't. I don't know if it was illegal, but it was immoral and unethical as well.
I'm talking from
why don't we go after everybody in Congress that's doing immoral things, everybody in the Senate that's doing immoral things? Why are we just going after Trump?
I understand.
We just need to go after all the corrupt people that's in government, including Trump.
No, because then you're taking the whole system. Like,
we need to take out the whole system to start up again.
I don't think we need to bother with them. I think we need to start building our own.
Take down the whole system and build it back up.
All right, so you tell us why you think that we shouldn't go after all of them. You can talk about the NAFTA and trades we just talked about. And then we're going to talk about we don't need to go after them at all, that we need to just do our own thing.
All right, so, like, I'm going to refine this and condense it. Pretty much, here's the thing. I understand that a lot of people in my community may not care about the overall standing of the United States from a global perspective. I understand that. And with good reason, because a lot of us don't have any reason to believe in this system. It's failed us for decades. Like, I go through the same problems with law enforcement that my grandfather did. I understand that. But the point I'm trying to say is this. I believe that we can make this system work for us if we attack this in the proper way. And I also believe that we have the best opportunity to do so more than any other point in this country's history right now. Like, right now. Right now is the easiest time in America where people can establish and create wealth. That's the end goal, right? That's the thing. But we have to have a political support system in order to do that.
But
like, it is necessary. There is no other way around it. Because every other community that has built a sustainable, you know, like, community-based economic system that's helped them out, they have a political pipeline that allows for that to happen.
How is it easy to create wealth?
That's different, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. So, I think that's what Bella wants to talk about.
Yeah, oh, the political system starts from the top down. So, all right, when social norms begin to erode in any republic, that's when you start seeing it slip. That's when you start seeing things like that normally should work, systems and functions and mechanisms and isms that normally work begin to, like, not work in the way that they haven't for centuries, right? So what I'm saying is we cannot allow that to happen. If our goal is to build sustainable wealth, our goal needs to, we need to have a stable ship. Donald Trump represents an unstable ship. There are so many crises going on, and it's funny, like,
tell us about them, because we don't understand.
Diplomatic crisis. We have the least amount of diplomatic officers ever in this country's modern history appointed.
What do you mean? You mean overseas?
Everywhere. Appointed in the countries, embassies, all that. Trade. We're starting to get into senseless trade wars that's destroying the farming industry. There's farmers who voted for Trump, gun home, make America great again, who are, like, literally losing everything because of this trade war.
It's not senseless to us. It's not senseless to them. They have an agenda and
but
a reason that they're
what doing. I'm saying is, if they are having a bad time in a system that works for them, what do you think that means for us who are having a bad time and system that doesn't work for us?
So we're gonna have a worse time. We're actually gonna go to Bella for a couple minutes, and then we're gonna get back to you, Sammy.
So, I mean, first I'll just talk about his point where he said, if they're having a bad time in a system that works for them, you know, what does that mean for us? Well, I think that means opportunity for us, which is what I mentioned before. If we're prepared in the proper way, that means opportunity for us, because now they're going to lose out a little bit as far as, you know, their stronghold, as far as their foundation. If their foundation is shaky, this is the best time for us if we're prepared. We're not prepared right now. I'll tell you that right now. We're not. But this is the best time for us. What was the other thing you wanted me to talk about?
Basically, why you think, how basically are we going to start our own thing? Like, okay. I know you went over that.
Right.
How could people take advantage of what's actually going on in the country?
And I just want to clarify, too. Like, obviously, like, I'm mixed or whatever you want to call me. So it's like, it's not necessarily, for me, it's not necessarily about a race thing. It's about oppressors versus oppressed, right? Because for me personally, if I wanted to assimilate, I easily could. I could easily straighten my hair, talk a certain way, dress a certain way, and assimilate. But I see the immorality in what's done to other people, and I can't be a part of that. So it's not necessarily just about race. So I just want to clarify, when I'm talking about what we can do, it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, a racial thing or whatever. It just means what oppressed peoples can do to come together and rise up and bring themselves out of this. So for me, like, okay, you had mentioned before, like, oh, maybe we should just go after all the corrupt people then, right? But I don't see that as a viable solution, because, right, we're already saying these people are corrupt. So, like, what is your idea to go after them and do what? Rehabilitate them so that they're no longer corrupt?
No. Like, no, just have...
That was me who said that.
Just have stable management and, like, something that is not affecting systems in place that literally promote norms.
But, okay, so like, you're dealing
we're
with
in
people,
the red.
You're dealing with people who are immoral. Right, you're dealing with people who don't hold value for human life.
We can't affect
you're dealing
that,
with
though.
People.
We can only...
But why are we letting them... Why are we letting them run society?
We don't let them do anything. They took society. We need to
no,
take it back.
We are... Exactly.
We gave them the society.
No, we didn't give it.
No,
it was taken from
right now,
us.
We're allowing them to do that because we should be focused on building our own instead of trying to regulate them. Why are we trying to regulate people who have no regard for our lives? That doesn't make any sense.
It's not us who does deregulating. Like, again.
But that's what we're talking about. We're talking about voting. We're talking about, you know, putting them on trial. We're talking about
taking Trump out of office.
So
that's regulation, right? You're talking about taking people to trial, voting for people, putting people in office, taking people out of office. So we're talking about regulating people that have no regard for our lives.
That's more.
They're not moral people.
You are talking in a general sense of again, oppressors and oppressed.
Correct.
I understand that. I'm talking about right now in the present how there's a guy in charge of a system that is the most important system on the planet,
and
who
the oppressors.
Does not know what he's doing.
And he's an oppressor.
He's an oppressive system as well.
Yeah, he's an oppressor.
And
but
the system
what I'm saying
is full of oppressors.
If
they
he fails,
the
and, but it's a game though. If he fails, we all fail.
No.
If
he fails, that's an opportunity for us.
No, it's not.
If we're
think,
ready.
If there's going to be nothing left for us to take over.
I think he's saying that when they fail, when the system falls, we all go into anarchy.
Like, we don't have anything to work towards.
If he fails, then we also got somebody else to worry
about.
Because
if we have a system in place, again, when power falls, when a government falls or anything falls, there's a void. And whoever's prepared at that time to fill that void is going to fill it.
Yeah, but we're the farthest away from being prepared for it, though. Everybody else has more than
we
do.
So that's what we should be focusing on, rectifying that.
You're being prepared to take over.
I think she's saying we should be preparing to take over instead of preparing to save the system so we can take over later.
I respectfully disagree. I feel like we need to save the system first while preparing.
I don't think
we
should
save the people who are murdering us every day.
Listen, look, it sucks, but look, overall,
I'm gonna say the system that holds us all together. I guess the question is, since we are not prepared right now, and the system fell tomorrow,
okay,
what will we do?
It's not gonna fall tomorrow.
No, but.
That's a false hypothetical. That's a straw man argument because you're giving me something that's of course not gonna happen.
How do you know that though? When the banking crisis happened during the Great Depression, this happened overnight. The economists knew
the banking crisis happened. They knew that it was coming.
So 2008, the regular people,
so
didn't know.
So give me worst case scenario. What is it? What would a collapse tomorrow look like, and then I can respond to it.
Oh! I can spell that out easily. First off, we'll start with the constitutional crisis. That's first and foremost, right?
What do you mean constitutional?
Constitutional crisis. So. Example, we're about to touch on this, right? Let's say Donald Trump fires Robert Mueller, right? The guy who's investigating whether the president of the United States had anything to do with a cyber attack on the United States of America. Yeah. So basically, saying whatever. Constitutional crisis is when one of the branches of government, a constitutional crisis is when one of the branches of government fail, like begin to fail to discharge their duty. So like, let's say the legislative branch is unable to legislate anymore, whatever, like that. Then that basically means we're in a constitutional crisis.
What's next?
Yeah. So Donald Trump represents the executive branch.
Okay.
The president of the United States represents the executive branch. So if the president of the United States is unable to discharge, the executive branch is unable to discharge its duties, we fall into a constitutional crisis.
So basically,
that's you on a highway, on a car, going 120 miles per hour, and the person driving decides to go in the backseat and piss in the bottle. That's basically what we're dealing with. So boom, imagine what's going on. You're like, hey, yo, bro, I need to get back. Like, I don't know why you pissing in the bottle in the backseat on the highway. Car swerving, right? So the first thing that's going to happen is an economic collapse. You think 2008 was serious? No. No. It's going to be really, 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 really bad for us. We are the ones that lose the jobs. The low-paying jobs, the ones that we slave over.
We
haven't seen anything like that before. Like, the closest we've come to anything like this was the Watergate scandal with Richard Nixon. But that was even...
So what? Constitutional crisis is your first thing?
Yeah.
Economic collapse?
Economic collapse.
What else?
After that.
Is that
so,
it?
So then after that... The wealthiest of us, the ones with the most resources, are going to be the ones to fall into the void.
Well, before we get to the void, though, I think there's more steps. You said constitutional crisis, you said economic.
No, it's two steps. Political and economic. It's done.
Wait, let me address
that. Those are two main ones. Like, there's nothing after that.
First of all, you're talking about constitutional crisis, right? You're like, he's about to fire this guy that's trying him and this and that, whatever.
That was an example.
Constitutional crisis
is when a branch of government cannot discharge its duties.
Following the Constitution.
Yeah.
Okay. So first of all, the Constitution was never for us.
Right.
That's first and foremost.
Right.
Okay.
But it can
hold
be
on,
though.
Hold on. All of our leaders historically have been assassinated. So the Constitution clearly don't apply to us.
Doesn't. But it can.
But it doesn't. So what would change for us if the Constitution collapses when it's a Constitution that already doesn't serve us? Nothing.
And you only mentioned
nothing because our leaders will get assassinated anyway, right? Our leaders are not under the protection of the Constitution. Our people are not under the protection of the Constitution. We don't have rights.
You only mentioned the constitutional crisis and the economic crisis. What if
now,
that,
economic,
how did that really like keep going? Like
that means basically the country starts failing to discharge its duties.
Tell us everything, because
I know what he means,
but I'm saying everybody that's watching might not know exactly what you mean, though. So I want you to
expand on economic crisis.
What you're talking about.
Economic crisis. All right, cool. So pretty much, we all know different work classes, right? Work class, middle class, whatever, right? So working class pretty much consists of people who like have to go to work to make money, right? So like, if you have to wake up and you have to go to your job to get paid or whatever, you're part of the working class. Middle class is people who can afford some leeway. They have a job or whatever. They probably have a house, couple cars, married, blah, 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 blah. And then there's upper middle class, then there's the 1%, right? So middle class are business owners, basically, right? Business owners and people who have high salary jobs, right? 1% is the people who run corporations, right?
Yeah.
Right? The working class are people who work in retail, restaurants, anything that requires that. When you don't have a working class, right? Working class, which in capitalism are the biggest consumers. When you don't have a working class, right? When that starts to biggest consumers can't spend money, nobody makes money. So what's going to start happening is we're going to be the ones on short end of the stick because we already don't have anything. We don't have anything. We don't have anything to go, you know what?
We already are on the short end of the stick.
No. Like, it's more than that. Like, we don't have commodities.
Tell us like, the consequences of an economic crash, though. Like, say, for instance, you a regular family, you know, as a husband and a wife, you know. You got, like, five kids.
You can't get
kids.
A job. You got five kids, none of y'all work, what happens?
So you're saying unemployment.
Unemployment, well.
So that's the worst that can happen?
That's like, no.
This dude. All right.
6 months.
All right, cool.
There's still other stuff, like.
Unemployment.
People go to like food pantries and.
No. You don't understand. Like,
yeah, right? So I'm saying.
Unemployment. Like, and this is all in the midst of like, we haven't even touched on what law enforcement is doing to our communities. We haven't even gotten into like figuring out what that whole thing is about. Like, that's going to be another problem that we have to deal with. Like, what you think they like wilding on us right now? Like, what you think? Our neighbors aren't gonna be the first ones that they come into try to make sure everything is a certain way. Nah, bro. They already do that to us right now when we already have money. That's gone. Like,
if they don't have money, what will make them want to do that again? But actually, though, our time is kind of up. I mean, if y'all have more time, we would like to continue this maybe in the office or something.
Hell yeah.
Okay, so we're taking this in the office. We gotta end the show for right now. So y'all know.
Thank you for coming to see our show. You know, your host, George, Political Thoughts.
Co-host, QP the Preacher. Guest stars, Saints Barreau. Founder and president of RECKLAW Hamilton Entertainment Company. And Bella Matias, the founder and president of Urban Community Solutions, not-for-profit. And their links will be in this when we post it. Thank you, y'all.
So we go practice. We gonna start the show.
Yo, you're baller.
You know, we still have.
Tell him, George, you're a baller.
We still have Miss Bella Matias, the president and founder of Urban Community Solutions. And we also have Saints Barreau, the president and founder of RECKLAW Hamilton Entertainment Company. Our host George. We go basically finish the conversation. So
I just let y'all talk, you know.
So Mr. Saints Barreau, was talking about. You didn't explain what you were saying about.
Basically, I'm saying is like there are so many problems going on with our government right now, and in terms of functionality, like
Keep going.
The functionality of our government is pretty much not working the way it should work. Diplomacy is so much a part of our foreign policy, and it never changes. Every single administration keeps exactly the same. It's the first time ever where we're lacking.
What do you mean by we're lacking?
We don't have enough diplomats. Like, literally, we don't have enough diplomats.
What does that mean? Tell us what that means.
All right, so a diplomat.
Give us examples, too.
A diplomat is a foreign officer who's appointed to work on the behalf of the U.S. government in other countries. Right.
So you're saying like if we had sent somebody
they work in embassies.
International relations.
Yeah. International relations. They work in embassies and assigned countries around the world. Right?
Okay.
These embassies are run by ambassadors.
Okay.
Right? So we don't have ambassadors appointed into key allies that we have around the world.
And why do we care?
Well, because the world is starting to look to China and Russia as pretty much its main problem solvers. So what that does is that shrinks U.S. influence across the globe. Now, if it shrinks U.S. Influence across the globe, basically that translates into the United States not making enough money as they should. Now, it's important that people pay attention to this because the national debt that we have is growing, like by trillions of dollars. And our upkeep pretty much barely enables us to pay interest on this debt. So like some presidents have worked it down to 10 trillion, whatever. But like in the most recent years, Obama was the one who added the most to this debt. But we had a machine where we were able to keep up with the interest. People don't add that part. Right now with Donald Trump has like added like 5 trillion within the first year of his presidency. And we're not having any means or mechanisms to make this money back. This affects everybody in the country, regardless of how we feel about the history, regardless of how we feel it affects us, regardless of how we feel like we're being oppressed in it. It affects all of us negatively. That's what I'm saying. There's a crisis in terms of a branch of our government not being able to execute its function either. Like the executive branch, it's frivolously.
Donald Trump has fired like I don't know how many people Donald Trump has fired from his. His cabinet is a revolving door. Also from the FBI. But it's like, it just, to me, it's like right now we're living in a dictatorship in America because everybody that he doesn't like, he fires.
We're in fascism already.
Yeah, like.
When's the last time a Secretary of State was fired mid presidential term? That never happens.
But he fires like people like every week. Like somebody he doesn't like, he fires them. Like
they should have never voted for him.
Though. Donald Trump's on his third chief of staff right now. People don't understand that.
Valid.
He's on his third chief of staff right now.
All the people that voted for him are now feeling his wrath and like, oh crap, I should never have voted for him.
Oh, well, they shouldn't have voted for him. That's what Americans get for being stupid.
Now you know. If Donald Trump is going for a re-election, don't vote for him.
Under false pretenses. The things that they voted for to change are things that don't exist.
They voted for him because they're retarded. Oh, no, that's the people are retarded. They voted for him because they're stupid. They're uneducated. They refuse to actually educate themselves.
Ignorance is not the same as stupidity.
They voted for him because
they weren't ignorant to the facts.
Yes, they
didn't study. No, they didn't study the facts. They had ample time to study, and they still chose to vote for Donald Trump.
Yo, son,
they voted too for gullible.
Donald Trump, despite all his transgressions, despite his racist remarks, despite his sexist remarks, despite everything that he did, they still voted for him. So nobody was ignorant to what was going on. Right? They knew who they put in office when
America
they put in office,
is gullible,
and they chose
also
to do it anyway.
Yeah,
it's not about gullible. It's about the illusion that has been created for people, and people have not broken out of that illusion. Like, we're all talking about finance and the economy and which superpower is in charge, and honestly, it's all an illusion, right? Because it's not which country or which president or which person is in charge. It's a class struggle, right? It's the elites versus the lower class, basically. You know, the elites, essentially, why are you laughing? You're throwing me up. So, it's the elites versus the lower class, because the elites are, again, like I said before, they're power hungry, they're basically sociopathic megalomaniacs, and they thrive off of power and off of oppressing others, right? So it has nothing to do with which superpowers are power, this or that, whatever, right? Politics is basically the entertainment division of the military-industrial complex.
That was beautifully said.
Yeah, it was.
Thank you. So it's just theatrics at the end of the day. That's all it is. It's theatrics. It's things to keep you busy. It's things to make you feel like there's a side that's for you or whatever the case.
So, like, but you don't think that there's basic functions that have to happen in order to maintain the integrity of that system?
What integrity?
Like, the integrity in terms of not...
There is no
integrity. No. Integrity not from a moral standpoint. Integrity in terms of structure. Like, as if I was talking about the integrity of a bridge. Or the integrity of a desk. Like in order for this desk to stay upright, there has to be things
intact.
Why would
I want this government to stay upright? I don't support this government.
It doesn't matter if you support the government. You're affected if it collapses.
I'm affected if it doesn't collapse, though.
Correct.
You're affected
I'm
either
affected
way.
Now.
You're going to be affected either way if it collapses.
We're all affected.
I'm affected in a negative way
but
now.
You're going to be affected if it collapses or doesn't collapse.
We should be trying to get this system to work for us.
No.
We cannot get this system to collect for us. The only way we're going to get this system to work for us if we control the system and we be part of the system.
Or create our own system?
Yes.
You cannot create your own system.
Why?
It's too much. Look.
BS.
Isn't capitalism a new system in this world?
No, it's relatively, yeah, but like the amount of wealth.
Isn't communism new as well?
Listen,
so you know how some buildings are like, the old, you know how some buildings that they have old buildings and they turn them to new. So what we would do is gut out the old and put it in with the new. That's why you know you see these old buildings and you be like, oh, but once you go inside, you see everything inside. The interior is new, but the exterior is old. So we're gonna. It's like it's not rebuilding the wheel. It's just putting it's like just repairing it. We're gonna repair it instead of because you don't want to like build straight from the bottom. It's like having another revolution.
But we're not even if we want to build our own system, we're not building from the bottom up. We're not building from scratch because we have resources now that we didn't have years ago. Okay, let's be honest. First of all, hold on, I'm gonna tell you. So first of all, we have technology. We have the internet. We have all these things that we didn't have before. So the time that it took them to build this civilization, okay, it took decades, centuries, whatever. The technology that we have at our disposal now, it's not going to take us that same amount of time to do it. So we're not starting from scratch because we have resources that we didn't have back then because of industry and because of technology.
Well, one of our listeners, Asabudo, he actually had a comment. And he actually created his own social media site so we could get away from using Facebook. So I'm going to say his comment. He said, the system can work for us, but it will take 2 to 3 generations having 3 to 6 children. George. Having 3 to 6 children per woman. He said, on a base of Afrocentric education.
Yo, all right. So,
I don't think that's a lot of babies, but
I can understand that.
I mean, you ain't the one who got to pop them out, but you know, that's okay.
Facts. But look, I understand that perspective, 36. but like, real talk, look, they are scared of us affecting change because it's possible. Like, look, whenever we have
they're scared of unity.
No, not unity.
Yeah, that's what they are. They're scared of unity.
No. Affecting change. Look, affecting change. Look, the Black Panther Party, right? Uh-huh. Right? They literally systematically eliminated. We started to establish a direct pipeline of political influence. The Black Panther Party was a political party. People think it's like this club or something. No, it was a political party that was changing laws, like getting legislation passed and things of that nature to help us. Like they were doing things
and
in the community.
And how did they do that? And how did they do that? They did that by doing things for the community on their own.
But look.
That's how they did that. They didn't do it by appealing to the government or appealing to the cops. They said, we want to do it for our own community. No, it is true. They ran the breakfast program for kids. Okay, they had health care in the community that they were running.
Also advocated people to vote too, though.
Hold on. They had health care that they were running. They had the breakfast program for kids. What else did they have? They were policing the police. They were policing the police. So they were doing things outside of politics completely.
No, but like they were also advocates of getting people to vote. They were advocates for that. They would get truckloads of people and bring them to the polls. Why? Like they
and
wanted,
have you seen an improvement in politicians?
No, but here,
exactly.
Here's my point, though. No. Look, here's my point, though.
Yes or no, though? Them getting people to vote. Have you seen an improvement in politicians?
They systematically assassinated all the leadership of the Black Panther. They didn't have time enough.
You're proving my point.
No, I'm not proving your point. Why do you think they would go to the extremes of
assassinating everybody?
If they weren't affecting change and it wasn't working.
You're saying we can affect change, but then you're saying in the same breath, oh, but then they assassinated all our leaders. So we can't affect change that way, because if we try to affect change that way, they're going to
assassinate us. That's why they assassinate them, because it's working.
Obviously, it didn't. It failed.
No, it did not fail. They killed these people. Like, they were worried enough to, like, where they're like, this thing is working to the point where we cannot allow this to continue.
So you, hold on. So you believe that if they hadn't been assassinated, that we would have, gotten politicians who were going to positively change our lives.
Yes, I'm explaining. Ronald Reagan was the governor of California.
I can't agree with him, though.
I don't agree.
Ronald Reagan was the governor of California back when the Black Panthers started to emerge.
Ronald Reagan, he was one of the
first. Let me finish my point. Dr. Huey P. Newton is obviously the co-founder of the Black Panther Party in Oakland, California. Right. California was an open carry state.
Okay.
During Ronald Reagan's term as government. What happened was Ronald Reagan passed, like, when the Black Panthers started policing the police,
correct,
walking around the streets with AKs.
Yes.
Guess what happened?
They passed
gun registration to prevent that from happening.
Okay.
So, like, you don't think that's affecting positive change?
No, hell no.
You're influencing the political process with. With your actions,
that's not positive. What have you? What is crazy? Hold on. So the police are killing Black and Brown people.
They have open carry laws
with complete immunity, right? They're not getting persecuted. They're not getting prosecuted. Nothing. They're walking away scot free. We finally step up and say, "Nah, we're gonna police them." And what is the response of the politicians?
They make laws to stop us from doing that.
Exactly.
Which tells me that they're scared. It's working.
That's
what I'm saying.
That's not positive. That's not positive.
They know. Exactly. How is that positive? Illegally.
How is it positive? Now they stripped you of your guns, and now they can continue killing you with impunity. What are you talking about?
I got a question there.
You understand my point, right?
That's not positive at all.
This is poetically minded.
I think we got either two choices. Either we get weapons and go start killing all the police.
I don't know about that.
Bro, you talking crazy right now.
Okay,
I know before.
I'm a man here.
Question,
I know we need to reform police.
Listen,
so to make sure that you can stop killing our brothers and sisters.
Talking about reforming the police.
I'm serious. Pause that.
No. So I'm gonna go on either side of the spectrum now. So either we can have a revolution, and you know what that entails, and everything that can be inside of a revolution, or we can do this in a diplomatic, democratic, somewhat peaceful way.
Okay, there's a third option.
So what's the third option?
The third option is, okay, eventually it may entail a revolution, depending on the powers that be, okay? So the third option is what I've been talking about the whole time, is about us establishing our own, right? Now, let's be realistic. When we start to establish our own and we are thriving, there may be a chance that they are going to try and eradicate that.
So I have a question.
So at that point, go ahead.
They try to eradicate everything.
You don't think?
Of course.
You don't think that
because they want to keep the status quo.
You don't
power.
Think that like
of course, when a movement to power.
Gets to the point where like the government is trying to assassinate its leaders, you don't think that's an indication that that movement may be working?
I didn't say it was a okay. So let me be clear, right? I'm not saying that what the Black Panthers were doing was not.
But
working.
It's not hold just on, them though. Hold on. It's every single leader we've had.
Right.
That's
exactly.
Of some importance.
Exactly. But I don't think that the method that they were afraid of was them affecting change in the political voting process. Wow. I don't think that's what they were afraid of. What they were afraid of is uniting the people. What they were afraid of is people getting together and making social change in their communities on their own, which many social movements did.
The FBI actually has a mandate that no Black person in the nation will rise to basically take seat of power.
Have you read
and
they also,
and the CIA also has a mandate that no African, no Black leader internationally will rise to the point where they can gain
so
power.
If they,
so these are actually mandates on an American.
All right, so it's a mandate for Blacks can be a power. So then we have a Latino freaking race to power, and then it's the same thing, but. It's a little different. We have a Latino one, and then we have to infiltrate.
First of all, let me tell you something. They consider us all the same. Trust me. That's number one. And number two,
No, I said the N-word, but last time I got blocked on Facebook for saying the N-word. Oh. Even though they used to call me the N-word, but now I can't say it, but that's another story.
And number two, you know, aside from them seeing us as all the same, we have to realize we are all the same. Okay, we all come from the same origin. All right, so if you Latino and you think you don't have African blood in you, I'm sorry, but you're sadly mistaken.
Of course.
So we have to start realizing to stop being divisive and stop falling into their tools of division.
Yep, I agree. 100%.
And realize that we are all the same. And on top of that, they view us as all the same. Yep. So we have to get past the small. Can I curse now since we're not on the radio show? Okay, we have to get past all the small little bullshit and realize what it really is, which again is goes back to class struggle. The super elite megalomaniac sociopaths versus oppressed peoples. Bottom line, that's it. And all of this thing that they have with politics is theatrics.
It's not all theatrics.
It is theatrics. You show me one government who has served the oppressed people that hasn't been tied in with America.
America is scared of communism, but Fidel before he turned a little crazy with his dictatorship. He did rise against his own government and made it good against for his people. But then he started to go a different way.
Because they worshipped America, though.
See, look, I disagree with this. If that was true, then people wouldn't be trying so hard to get us people of color so disinterested in the political process. Like, there's literally 1964 was when Black people could vote. Like, are we not understanding this? There are people still alive. Black people still alive.
So
we're
what?
Legally not allowed to vote in this country.
So what?
They're still alive.
So what?
Why do so much trouble to prevent these people from being able to be a part of that process?
Why do you want to be part of a process that didn't even have you in mind in the beginning, though? Because your question doesn't make sense.
Why is that so important for them to keep us out of it?
Because most of us viewers are already here. So if they try to make us part of the process, we could take the land back.
You want to know why it's so important to keep us out of the process? To maintain the illusion. That's why. Because if we become part of the process and then we outvote them by a landslide, now they have to figure out another way to stay in power and maintain the illusion at the same time.
But that's a good problem to have for us.
Poetically minded had a question.
I had two questions. One, has anybody heard of Memorandum 46? That's my first question.
He had a question, yeah.
Has anybody heard of Memorandum 46?
No.
No?
In what?
Memorandum 46.
What is it? Is it a doctrine? What is it?
It's like a basically like a when we tell you that like our meetings have minutes to them on the outline
of for what organization though?
For pretty much the U.S. government, it was like the Attorney General, the head of military, FBI was there.
Okay, go ahead, keep going.
So basically, in this memorandum, it talks about the things that could happen if Black people in America and Black people in Africa unite with each other. And why they can't allow that to happen, and
unite.
All the things they can do to separate that.
Unite.
You just said it. Unite. They don't want to listen to
unite. That's something that I said from the beginning. Is unity is necessary. Yes. Unite. That's very different from enter the voting process. That's very different from enter the political process.
Yeah. Let finish. Let Paul.
Why is this uniting so dangerous? If we're not going to unite and have a giant revolution, then what else are we going to do with this union? It's because, like he's saying, when you think about the U.S. government, you look back at the history of how when the Constitution was formed. The Constitution was formed pretty much by people who didn't want to be somewhere oppressed by King George or whatnot.
Supposedly.
They didn't want it. But anyway, the reason, that's why you have the checks.
Where all
balances.
This money come from?
Listen.
The family
country. Okay, listen, if you are a union and you're doing things for your community and you're not involved in the political process of your community, what happens when they start writing laws or doing bank, things baby, politically against you to where now they can come and say, oh, it's illegal for you to do that?
No, bro!
And you have no say in that. For instance, if they be like, oh, you know what? Now it's illegal for more than three Black dudes to sit on the street together with each other without having such and such permit and this and this
okay.
and that. And you let them do that because you're not involved in political
okay.
process.
Thank you.
Okay, first of all, legal and illegal doesn't matter. That's all part of the theatrics, okay?
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. I'm going to tell
it
you why.
It
hold
is.
On, let me finish. Hold on, let me finish. I'm going to tell you why
and
right
I'm
now.
Tell, I'm
going to
tell you
legal and illegal is all part of the theatrics, okay? Because you can have a white man do the same exact thing a Black man does, and there's going to be entirely different handling of those situations regardless of the law. Legal and illegal,
really
legal
next,
and illegal, legal and illegal is theatrics, okay? Hold on,
okay,
hold
no,
on.
No,
you have so many Black men killed every day without breaking the law. And those police officers who committed murder, who is illegal, walk scot-free. So what does legal, illegal have to do with anything? It's theatrics.
Who is judging them?
Hold on. What she said that is theatrics, I agree with her because things that I've learned in the past going on 3 decades in this country is all about what you own and control and what you can take. So legal and illegal, that's all fuzzy stuff that's imaginary. It's all about what you own, what you can control, and what you can take. That's what it's about.
Listen, I respectfully understand this point of view, but I'm saying is this. Look, the U.S. Constitution, whether we want to admit this or not, was a document that was designed to be amended. And the reason why this was put into place was to change with the times. Something that cannot evolve has a ceiling. That was the thought process. Something that cannot grow anymore has an end. It's finite.
Says
so,
people that own us at the time.
You can use that against them.
I'm not disagreeing with that, though.
That's not an illusion. That's a real thing. These people, anything that document says...
To what degree?
We
gotta
look at all the loopholes.
We
have to learn how to operate in Farrah's Court. That's literally...
No. You're talking about the Constitution, right? And you're talking about rights, right? What's the first right? The first right is your First Amendment, right? To freedom of speech and things like that. But what happened to all our leaders when they exercised that freedom of speech? They got assassinated. So what the Constitution does for us, it doesn't protect us at all. You can get killed for nothing. You can be walking down.
As an indication that's working, though.
Let me
like,
tell you something.
There's something going on. That's so important.
Point of order.
You have a freedom of speech, but to a certain extent.
You don't have any freedom. Stephen Clark got killed in his grandmother's backyard.
Oh, yeah,
for nothing. What freedom you have? And guess what? They'll probably walk because they always walk.
Of course.
What is legal, illegal? Constitution, no constitution. You have no rights. We have no rights. We have no protection.
Sound like you're talking about the Dred Scott case.
Why would nobody go reform that police officer?
Talking about the
Dred Scott case. Example. So
yeah, he got shot in the
Dred Scott case.
No, I was talking about Stephen Clark, but yeah.
The guy that got shot in the
back. I think that's one of the most recent.
The Dred Scott case was ruled that. Okay, you want to go into it?
So basically, the Dred Scott case was about a Black man who crossed into free territory, right? He basically was trying to sue for his freedom. He's like, oh, I'm in this state, I'm free.
Oh, yeah, I heard that.
And they were saying, look, like, you don't have a right to do this because you're a Black person. Like, it doesn't matter what you do. That's not important to us. Like,
so the ruling was basically that no white man has There's no law that we have that we can respect the black man.
Yeah, but that was back then. That was overturned. People don't want to talk about
when
that.
When was it overturned?
I don't recall.
And systematically, no, he lost. It's still in effect today.
It's like the example of white supremacy. It's not in effect today. Supposedly.
Systematically, it is. Bro.
Like,
it
is. Legally, it's not in effect, but like,
you all got
to figure it out. Legal is an illusion. How is it? Oh, listen to me. How is legal not an illusion?
Everything is on camera. If you want to revolutionize the officers, because, you know, revolution is on camera. They got badge numbers and revolutionary, you know, reform. We can go talk to them and, you know, tell them that they really hurt the families they did that to.
Very eager to revolutionize.
You can go to their house and knock on the door and say, sir, why did you shoot this?
I'm pretty sure you can't do that. But anyway.
I don't know how you're going to get the information. Yeah,
I got to get going.
You can add him on Facebook and say, sir, I'd like to meet with you.
Yo.
Yeah, I don't think
and have
an
interview.
I think you just gotta get yourself shot by doing that. Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to have a peaceful revolution.
So you wanna thank y'all for watching. Thursdays at 5:00, you know, Political Thoughts with George. I'm QP, the co-host.
This is Bella Mathias, president and founder of Urban Community Solutions. This is Mr. Sainsborough, president and founder of RECKLAW Hamilton Entertainment Company.
Your host, Political Thoughts with George.
And this is Mr. Poetically Minded.
Nah, I can't.